The Storm of War, A New History of the Second World War, by Andrew Roberts. Narrated by Christian Rodska. Copyright 2011 by Andrew Roberts. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with HarperCollins Publishers and was produced in the year 2011 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto.
I have myself full confidence that if all do their duty, if nothing is neglected, and if the best arrangements are made, as they are being made, we shall prove ourselves once again able to defend our island home, to ride out the storm of war, and to outlive the menace of tyranny, if necessary for years, if necessary alone.
Winston Churchill, House of Commons, the 4th of June, 1940. Prelude. The Pact. On Thursday, the 12th of April, 1934, General Werner von Blomberg, Germany's Reichswehr Minister, Minister of Defense, and thus the political master of the German armed forces, met the Chancellor of Germany, Adolf Hitler, aboard the Deutschland, an 11,700-ton pocket battleship. There they entered into a secret pact by which the army would support the Nazi leader in taking the presidency of Germany upon the death of Paul von Hindenburg, on condition that the Reichswehr would retain complete control over all matters military. The chief of the Sturmabteilung, SA or Brown Shirts, Ernst Röhm, had been pressing for a new ministry comprising all the armed forces of Germany, with himself at its head, a situation that augured ill for both Blomberg and, ultimately, possibly also for Hitler. Showing his readiness to put the Deutschland Pact into immediate effect, on the 1st of May, Blomberg ordered the incorporation of the swastika motif onto the uniforms of the armed forces. On the 21st of June, with Röhm forcefully continuing to press his case, Blomberg warned Hitler that unless measures were taken to secure internal peace, Hindenburg would declare martial law and ask the army to restore order, a situation that would leave the Chancellor sidelined and weakened. Hitler took the hint. 9 days later, his personal Schutzstaffel, SS bodyguard, acted with sudden ferocity against Röhm on what became known as the Blood Purge, or the Night of the Long Knives, in a series of summary kidnappings and executions that left 200 people dead. Not only did the army not act during the purge, but the very next day, the 1st of July, Blomberg issued an order of the day commending the Führer's soldierly decision and exemplary courage in liquidating the mutineers and traitors of the SA. A month later, on Thursday, the 2nd of August, 1934, Hindenburg died, and, with the complete support of the army, Hitler assumed the presidency, and with it, the supreme command of the armed forces, under a law agreed by the cabinet during Hindenburg's lifetime. Blomberg ordered that the new oath of allegiance be sworn to Hitler personally, rather than to the office of the presidency or the state. "I swear by God this sacred oath," its unambiguous wording went, "that I will render unconditional obedience to Adolf Hitler, the Führer of the German Reich and Volk, supreme commander of the armed forces, and will be ready as a brave soldier to risk my life at any time for this oath." At Hindenburg's funeral on the 7th of August, Blomberg suggested to the new president that all soldiers should henceforth address him as Mein Führer, a proposal which was graciously accepted. Hitler had won ultimate power, but only at the sufferance of the German army. And just 2 days after Hindenburg's funeral, on Thursday, the 9th of August, 1934, Blomberg wrote a terse one-sentence and hitherto unpublished letter to Hitler stating, "Mein Führer, ich bitte an die in Aussicht gestellte Verfügung, an die Wehrmacht erinnern zu dürfen." Blomberg, "My leader, I would like to remind you of your statement to the Wehrmacht." Blomberg, The tone was somewhat peremptory, reminding Hitler of his side of the Deutschland Pact, a pledge without which he would not have been able to gain the military and political supremacy that was to allow him, only 5 years later, to plunge the world into the most catastrophic war mankind has ever known. Blomberg was in a position to insist on proper observation of the pact, for, as the British historian of the German High Command, Sir John Wheeler Bennett, wrote, "Till August 1934, the army could have overthrown the Nazi regime at a nod from their commanders, for they owed no allegiance to the Chancellor. But with the acceptance of Hitler's succession, the generals had added one more fetter, perhaps the strongest of all, to those psychological bonds which chained them ever more inescapably to a regime which they had thought to exploit and dominate." A week after receiving Blomberg's letter, Hitler published the full text of Hindenburg's last will and testament in the Nazi Party newspaper Völkische Beobachter. This document stressed that in the Third German Reich, the guardian of the state, the Reichswehr, must be the symbol of and firm support for this superstructure. On the Reichswehr, as a firm foundation, must rest the old Prussian virtues of self-realized dutifulness, of simplicity, and of comradeship. Always and at all times, the Reichswehr must remain the pattern of state conduct, so that, unbiased by any internal political development, its lofty mission for the defense of the country may be maintained. The thanks of the Field Marshal of the World War and its Commander-in-Chief are due to all the men who have accomplished the construction and organization of the Reichswehr. The next day, the 19th of August, the German people voted in a plebiscite on whether Hitler should hold the combined offices of President and Reich Chancellor, with more than 38 million people, or 89.9%, voting yes. On the 20th of August, Hitler continued to repay his Deutschland debt, writing to Blomberg, and in effect confirming, that the secret pact was still operative. He thanked the general for the army's oath of loyalty, and added, "I shall always regard it as my highest duty to intercede for the existence and inviolability of the Wehrmacht, in fulfillment of the testament of the late Field Marshal, and in accord with my own will to establish the army firmly as the sole bearer of the arms of the nation." Nothing so consolidated the Führer's standing with his generals as the series of politico-diplomatic coups that he pulled off around the borders of Germany between March 1936 and August 1939, which turned the humiliated power of the Versailles Treaty, under which she had lost 13.5% of her territory, into the potentially glorious Third Reich. Hitler's regular protestations of pacific intentions worked well in lulling foreigners' suspicions, but were correctly seen as utterly bogus by the senior commanders of the Wehrmacht, Kriegsmarine and Luftwaffe, whom he was simultaneously ordering to prepare for a general European conflict sooner rather than later. "Germany will, of its own accord, never break the peace," he told the journalist G. Ward Price of London's Daily Mail in February 1935, for example. But a few days later, he decided that the Wehrmacht needed to be increased from 21 to 36 divisions as soon as possible. His intention was to have a 63-division army, almost the same size as in 1914, by the year 1939. The tempo of Hitlerian aggression increased exponentially during the second half of the 1930s, as the German dictator gained in confidence and the generals absented themselves from political decision-making. Hermann Göring's official announcement of the existence of the Luftwaffe took place in March 1935, the same month that Germany publicly repudiated the disarmament clauses of the Versailles Treaty, clauses that she'd been secretly ignoring ever since Hitler had come to power. That September, the Nuremberg laws effectively outlawed German Jews and made the swastika the official flag of Germany. It was on the 7th of March, 1936, that Hitler comprehensively violated the Versailles Treaty by sending troops into the industrial region of the Rhineland, which, under Article 180, had been specifically designated a demilitarized zone. Had the German army been opposed by the French and British forces stationed nearby, it had orders to retire back to base, and such a reverse would almost certainly have cost Hitler the chancellorship. Yet the Western powers, riven with guilt about having imposed what was described as a Carthaginian peace on Germany in 1919, allowed the Germans to enter the Rhineland unopposed. After all, said the influential liberal politician and newspaper director, the Marquis of Lothian, who'd been Chancellor of the Duchy of Lancaster in Ramsay MacDonald's national government, they're only going into their own back garden. When Hitler assured the Western powers in March 1936 that Germany wished only for peace, Arthur Greenwood, the deputy leader of the Labour Party, told the House of Commons, Herr Hitler has made a statement holding out the olive branch, which ought to be taken at face value. It is idle to say that those statements are insincere. That August, Germany adopted compulsory 2-year military service. November 1936 saw active German intervention in the Spanish Civil War, when Hitler sent the Condor Legion, a unit composed of over 12,000 volunteers, as well as Luftwaffe warplanes, to support his fellow fascist, General Francisco Franco. Benito Mussolini's fascist Italy, meanwhile, sent forces that were eventually to number 75,000 men. It was in Spain that the technique of carpet bombing was perfected by the Legion, which dropped nearly 2.7 million pounds of bombs and fired more than 4 million machine gun bullets. Britain and France held a conference in London attended by 26 countries, which set up a committee to police the principle of non-intervention in Spanish affairs. Both Germany and Italy took seats on it, which they kept until June 1937, by which time the farce could not be played out any longer. November 1936 also saw Germany, Japan, and subsequently Italy sign the Anti-Comintern Pact, aimed at opposing the USSR's Third Communist International, but also creating what became known as the Axis. The mise-en-scene for the Second World War was almost in place, except for one sensational twist in the plot still to come. For the moment, however, Hitler cranked up his saber-rattling policy towards his neighbours, and particularly those with large German populations contiguous with the borders of the Reich. That it was all part of a wider master plan, albeit one that was to be moved forward as opportunities presented themselves, was conclusively proven by the minutes of a meeting he called at the Reich Chancellery for 4:15 p.m. on Friday the 5th of November, 1937. This lasted nearly 4 hours and was intended to leave the senior executive officers of the Reich under no illusions about where his plans were leading. Speaking to Blomberg, who'd been made the first field marshal of the Third Reich in 1936, General Werner von Fitsch, commander-in-chief of the Wehrmacht, Admiral Erich Raeder, commander-in-chief of the German Navy, Göring, commander-in-chief of the Luftwaffe, and Foreign Minister Baron Konstantin von Neurath, with the minutes taken carefully by his adjutant, Colonel Friedrich Hosbach, the Führer began by stating that the purpose of the meeting could not be discussed before the Reich Cabinet just because of the importance of the matter. He then explained how the histories of the Roman and British empires had proved that expansion could be carried out only by breaking down resistance and taking risks. These risks, by which he meant short wars against Britain and France, would have to be taken before the period 1943-1945, which he regarded as the turning point of the regime, because after that time, the world would be expecting our attack and would be increasing its countermeasures from year to year. It would be while the world was still preparing its defences that we would be obliged to take the offensive. Before then, In order to protect Germany's flanks, Hitler intended to overthrow Czechoslovakia and Austria simultaneously and with lightning speed in an Angriffskrieg, offensive war. He believed that the British and French had already tacitly written off the Czechs, and that, without British support, offensive action by France against Germany was not to be expected. Only after the speedy destruction of first Austria and Czechoslovakia, and then Britain and France, could he concentrate on the creation of a vast colonial empire in Europe. The seeming immediacy of these plans deeply alarmed Blomberg and Fritsch. Fritsch even proposed postponing his holiday, which was due to start the following Wednesday, and both men repeatedly emphasized the necessity that Britain and France must not become our enemies. Together, Blomberg and Fritsch might have been able to prevent Hitler carrying out the last part of the Hossbach plans. Yet, on the 27th of January, 1938, Blomberg was forced to resign his powerful post when it emerged that his new bride, Margarete Grün, who was 35 years his junior, had, in 1931, posed for pornographic photographs taken by a Czech Jew with whom she had been cohabiting, and that she'd also graced a register of known prostitutes kept by the Berlin police force. To make matters worse, both Hitler and Hermann Göring had stood witness for the couple at their wedding in the War Ministry on the 12th of January. Within a week, Fritsch was also forced to resign on suspicion of being blackmailed by a Berlin rent boy called Otto Schmidt, a charge of which he was innocent and later exonerated in court on the grounds of mistaken identity. It is likely that he'd been framed by Heinrich Himmler, head of the SS, but any collective opposition to his sacking by the German generals was undermined by General Wilhelm Keitel, a devotee of Hitler. Although Hitler had sought neither outcome, he was swift in exploiting the potentially embarrassing situation and used it massively to extend his personal control over Germany's armed forces. By appointing no formal successor to Blomberg, he effectively took over the role of war minister himself, appointing Keitel to be his advisor on all Wehrmacht matters, a man who was selected on the basis of his sycophancy and his solid lack of personality and intellect. From then on, Hitler gave orders directly to the Army, Navy and Air Force, Keitel explained to an interviewer at the Nuremberg trials after the war. No one issued orders independently of Hitler. Of course, I signed them, but they originated with Hitler. It was the wish and desire of Hitler to have all the power and command reside in him. It was something he could not do with Blomberg. In replacing Blomberg and Fritsch with himself and Keitel, de facto, if not immediately de jure, Hitler had finally sealed his control of the German armed forces. Within days, he carried out a massive reorganization of the top echelons of the military machine. 12 generals, not including Blomberg and Fritsch, were dismissed, and the occupants of no fewer than 51 other posts were reshuffled. The way was now clear for Hitler to establish complete domination of Germany's armed forces. Over the coming years, he would become more and more closely involved in every aspect of strategic decision-making, both through Keitel and through his equally obedient deputy, Colonel, later Major General, Alfred Jodl. The German high command, proud, often Prussian, much of it aristocratic, and just as resentful of the humiliations of 1918-19 as anyone else in the Reich, allowed its traditional role of creating grand strategy to be usurped by a man who many of them admired as a statesman, but whose talent as a military strategist none of them knew anything about. And all because of a former prostitute and a mendacious Berlin rent boy. As it turned out, Austria did not need to be fought in order to be absorbed into the Reich. On the 11th of March, 1938, German troops entered the country and encountered enough genuine popular support for Hitler to declare Anschluss, political union, 2 days later, before being driven in triumph through the streets of Vienna. Although the union of the two countries had been expressly forbidden by the Versailles Treaty, Hitler presented the West with a fait accompli. The only shots fired in anger during Anschluss were by the many Jews who committed suicide as the Wehrmacht crossed the border. The next crisis, over the German-speaking Sudeten areas of Czechoslovakia awarded to Prague at Versailles, was handled as deftly by Hitler as the earlier ones. The Sudeten Germans had been agitating to join the Reich in carefully orchestrated demonstrations, which had occasionally, as in October 1937, descended into violence. In November, the Sudeten Nazis in the Czech parliament had staged a walkout, following a ban on political meetings. Hitler stoked the crisis adroitly through 1938, mobilizing the Wehrmacht on the 12th of August and demanding the annexation of the Sudeten areas to Germany the following month. As before, he stated that this would be his last territorial acquisition in Europe. On the 15th of September, the British Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain flew to Hitler's Alpine home in Berchtesgaden to try to negotiate a resolution of the crisis. On his return, he wrote to his sister Ida, "In short, I had established a certain confidence which was my aim, and on my side, in spite of the hardness and ruthlessness I thought I saw in his face, I got the impression that here was a man that could be relied upon when he had given his word." It required a second meeting with Hitler at Bad Godesberg a week later before Chamberlain was able to come to specific terms that Britain and France could urge the Czechs to accept in order to avoid a war for which the Western powers were still, unforgivably, unprepared. Reporting to the cabinet after his return from Godesberg, Chamberlain said that he believed that Hitler would not deliberately deceive a man whom he respected, with whom he had been in negotiation. It took a third meeting at Munich at the end of September before agreement could be reached between the Germans, Italians, British and French over the geographical extent and the timetable for the Sudeten's absorption into the Reich. Recommending the Munich agreement to the House of Commons, Chamberlain said on the 3rd of October, "It is my hope and my belief that under the new system of guarantees, the new Czechoslovakia will find a greater security than she has ever enjoyed in the past." For all the gross naivety of that statement, at least we can be sure that Chamberlain believed it. During the Munich period, the British government received a number of indications from anti-Nazi German generals that they would overthrow Hitler if the Western powers refused his blandishments over the Sudetenland. Yet these promises could not be relied upon, not least because they were not representative of the Wehrmacht officer class as a whole. The reasons why the German generals never overthrew their Führer, even once the war was certainly lost, are many. They include the fact that they could not necessarily count on the loyalty of their own men against Hitler. They were still isolated from public affairs. They felt bound by the oath of obedience to the Führer, which they had sworn. They stood for a conservative order, which did not appeal to German youth. And they found it impossible as a group to put their duty to Germany over their personal interests and ambitions. They were far too weak a reed for Chamberlain, and later Churchill, to base British foreign policy upon. A month after Munich, on the 2nd of November 1938, Hitler and Mussolini supported Hungary's annexation of southern Slovakia, which took place suddenly and without consultation with Britain and France. This reduced Chamberlain to stating in the House of Commons that, "We never guaranteed the frontiers as they existed. What we did was to guarantee against unprovoked aggression. Quite a different thing." A week later, the Nazis unleashed the vicious six-day pogrom against German Jews known to history as Kristallnacht, leaving few under any illusions about the vile nature of Hitler's regime. When on the 15th of March 1939, German troops occupied the Bohemian and Moravian rump of Czechoslovakia and dragged non-Germans into the Reich for the first time, and Hitler was driven through a sullen Prague in further triumph, the Chamberlain Ministry ran out of explanations and excuses, especially when later that month Hitler denounced the non-aggression pact that he'd signed with Poland 5 years before. On the 1st of April, Britain and France therefore guaranteed Poland, promising to go to war against Germany if she invaded. The guarantee was intended as a tripwire to deter any future adventures by Hitler, and similar promises were made to Romania and Greece a fortnight later. On the 27th of April, Britain introduced conscription for men aged 20 and 21. On the same day that Hitler denounced the 1935 Anglo-German naval agreement that had set limits to the size of both countries' fleets. The next month, Mussolini and Hitler signed a 10-year alliance known as the Pact of Steel. War is not only not inevitable, Sir Thomas Inskip, the Minister for Defence Coordination, nonetheless reassured the British public in August 1939, but it is unlikely. He'd not counted on Hitler pulling off perhaps the greatest coup of his entire career so far. With the German generals insisting that Poland should not be invaded unless Russia's neutrality had first been secured, Hitler decided upon the most astonishing political volte-face of the 20th century. In total contravention to everything he'd always said about his loathing of Bolshevism, he sent his new foreign minister, Joachim von Ribbentrop, to Moscow to negotiate with Joseph Stalin's new foreign minister, Vyacheslav Molotov. Placed beside the imperative for Stalin to encourage a war between Germany and the West, and the equal imperative for Hitler to fight a war on only one front rather than two, as in the Great War, their communist and fascist ideologies subsided in relative importance. And in the early hours of the 24th of August 1939, a comprehensive Nazi-Soviet non-aggression pact was signed. "All the isms have become wasms," quipped a British official. Up until that point, Hitler's treatment of the Austrian president Kurt von Schuschnigg, the Czech president Emil Hatcher, and the British and French leaders had been characterized by hucksterism, bullying, and constant piling on of pressure, to which they'd responded with a combination of gullibility, appeasement, and weary resignation. Yet with his lifelong enemies, the Bolsheviks, Hitler was attentive and respectful, though, of course, no less duplicitous. Their time would come. The Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact safely signed, Hitler wasted no time. 1 week later, on the evening of Thursday, the 31st of August 1939, an unnamed inmate of a German concentration camp was taken by the Gestapo to a radio transmitting station outside the frontier town of Gliwice. He was then dressed up in a Polish army uniform and shot. A propaganda story was quickly concocted, alleging that the Poles had attacked Germany, thus enabling Hitler to invade Poland in self-defense, without needing to declare war first. Operation Himmler, as this farcically transparent pantomime was codenamed, thus encompassed the very first death of the Second World War. Considering the horrific ways in which 50 million people were to die over the next 6 years, the hapless prisoner was one of the lucky ones. The Deutschland itself, launched in 1931, was renamed the Lutzau in 1940, because Hitler was concerned about the demoralizing effect if a ship of that name was sunk. For the same reason, he never allowed a ship to be named the Adolf Hitler, despite plenty of prompting from obsequious admirals. The Lutzau saw action off Norway in 1940, fought Allied convoy escorts in 1942, was heavily damaged in air raids, and was finally scuttled in May 1945, along with National Socialism itself. Yet had Hitler stuck to the terms of the pact that he agreed with Blomberg on board the battleship in April 1934, allowing the professional strategists of the Reichswehr to set the timing, course, and pace of the coming war, while he confined himself to boosting morale and making exhortations to self-sacrifice, might the outcome of the Second World War have been different? Might the pact that was made aboard the Deutschland have left Deutschland über alles? This is one of the questions which this book will seek to answer. Part 1. Onslaught. It is recorded of the great Moltke that when he was being praised for his generalship in the Franco-Prussian War, and was told by an admirer that his reputation would rank with such great captains as Napoleon, Frederick, or Turenne, he answered, "No, for I have never conducted a retreat." Frederick von Mellenthin, Panzer Battles, 1955. Chapter 1. Four Invasions. Part 1. September 1939 to April 1940.
"If we lose this war, then God have mercy on us."
Hermann Göring to Hitler's interpreter Paul Schmidt, the 3rd of September 1939. Although the international situation and his months of saber-rattling against Poland meant that his invasion of that country could not be a surprise attack, Hitler hoped, with good reason, that the Wehrmacht's new blitzkrieg, lightning war tactics, would deliver a tactical shock to the Poles. Blitzkrieg tactics, which relied on very close, radio-controlled contact between fast-moving tank columns, motorized artillery, Luftwaffe bombers and fighters, and truck-borne infantry, swept all before them. Hitler's dislike of static attritional warfare was a natural response to his years in the 16th Bavarian Infantry Regiment between 1914 and 1918. His job as a Meldegänger, battalion runner, in that conflict involved waiting for a gap in artillery salvos, and then springing forward in a semi-crouched stance, sprinting from trench to shell hole, taking messages. He was thus brave and conscientious, probably never killed anyone himself, and always refused promotions that would take him away from his comrades, because, as his regimental adjutant Fritz Wiedemann later stated, "For Gefreiter, Corporal Hitler, the regiment was home." He even won two Iron Crosses, second class and first class. Having survived 4 years of stalemate and attrition, Hitler had learnt by the age of 29 when the war ended that tactical surprise was of inestimable advantage in warfare, as he was later to write in Mein Kampf, "Even a man of 30 will have much to learn in the course of his life, but this will only be a supplement." Throughout his political career as a revolutionary, he constantly attempted to employ surprise, usually with great success. The attempted coup of 1923, known as the Beer Hall Putsch, had surprised even its titular leader, General Ludendorff, and Röhm had had no inkling of the Night of the Long Knives. Yet the Poles were expecting Hitler's sudden attack, because exactly 1 week beforehand their country had been invaded by a tiny detachment of Germans who had not been informed of the postponement of the invasion originally planned for dawn on Saturday, the 26th of August. Part of Germany's plan to invade Poland, Fall Weiß, Plan White, involved a small group of Germans dressed as Räuberzivil, robbers' civvies, crossing the border the night before and seizing key strategic points before dawn on the day of the invasion. The secret Abwehr, German intelligence battalion detailed to undertake these operations, was given the euphemistic title of Construction Training Company 800 for special duties. A 24-man group, under the command of Lieutenant Dr. Hans Albrecht Herschner, was instructed to prepare the way for the assault of the 7th Infantry Division by infiltrating the border and capturing a railway station at Moshti in the Jablunka Pass, running through the Carpathian Mountains, to prevent the destruction of the single-track railway tunnel, which was the shortest connection between Warsaw and Vienna. Crossing the border into the forests at 00:30 on the 26th of August, Hetzner's group got lost and was split up in the dark. But Hetzner managed to capture the railway station at Moshti with 13 men at 03:30 and cut the telephone and telegraph lines, only to discover that the Polish detonators had already been removed from the tunnel by the defenders. Polish tunnel guards then attacked his unit, wounding one of his men. out of contact with the Abwehr, Herzner could not know that, with only a few hours to go, the previous evening Hitler had postponed Plan White until the following week, and that every other commander unit had been informed of this except his. It was not until 09:35 that the Abwehr finally managed to get through and order Herzner, who by then had lost another man wounded and had killed a Pole in the firefight, to release his prisoners and return to base immediately. After a further series of incidents, Herzner's group recrossed the border at 13:30. The German government explained to the Poles that the whole affair had been a mistake due to the lack of a defined border line in the forest. As the operation had not been an official military one, therefore, and had taken place in peacetime, Herzner, very Teutonically, put in for overnight expenses of 55 Reichsmarks and 86 Pfennigs. Equally Teutonically, the authorities did not initially want to award him the Iron Cross, second class, for his exploits that technically took place in peacetime. They eventually did, but it did him little good. After breaking his back in a motor accident in 1942, Herzner drowned during his swimming therapy. On the 28th of August, Hitler had abrogated the 1934 German-Polish non-aggression treaty, a curious and unusual act of legalism for him, so the Poles could hardly have had a clearer indication that Germany was on the verge of invading their country. But they could have had little intimation of blitzkrieg tactics, hitherto the preserve of certain German and British theoretical tacticians. They could estimate accurately where and roughly when the attack would come, but crucially, not how. The Poles therefore chose to place the bulk of their troops close to the German border. The Munich crisis the previous autumn and Hitler's seizure of the rump of Czechoslovakia the following spring meant that Poland's border with the Reich had been extended from 1,250 to a full 1,750 miles, much further than the Polish army could adequately defend. Its commander-in-chief, Marshal Edward Smigliwicz, therefore had to decide whether to keep the majority of his forces back behind the natural defensive line formed by the Vistula, San, and Narew rivers, or to try to protect Poland's industrial heartlands and best agricultural lands in the west of the country. Smigliwicz decided to commit his troops to defending every inch of Polish soil, which left them perilously exposed. He attempted to deploy across the whole front from Lithuania to the Carpathians, and even kept a special assault group for invading East Prussia, retaining one-third of his force in Poznań and the Polish corridor. As so often in the history of poor, martyred Poland, the dispositions were brave. Otherwise, Smigliwicz would simply have had to abandon cities as important as Krakow, Poznań, Bydgoszcz and Lodz, which all lay to the west of the three rivers. Nonetheless, it is hard not to agree with Major General Frederick von Mellentin, then the intelligence officer of the German Third Corps, that Polish plans were lacking a sense of reality. At 17:30 hours on Thursday, the 31st of August 1939, Hitler ordered hostilities to start the next morning, and this time there would be no postponement. So at 04:45, on Friday, the 1st of September, German forces activated Plan White, which had been formulated that June by the German Army High Command, the Oberkommando des Heeres, OKH. The OKH was composed of the Commander-in-Chief of the Field Army, Feldheer, the Army General Staff, the Army Personnel Office, and the Commander-in-Chief of the Reserve Army, Ersatzheer. Above the OKH, in terms of creating grand strategy, was the Oberkommando der Wehrmacht, Armed Forces High Command, or OKW. Soon after assuming personal command of the German armed forces in February 1938, Hitler had created the OKW to function as his military staff under his direct command, with Keitel as its chief. Whereas Blomberg had been strenuously opposed by the Navy and Army in his efforts to set up a unified high command, Hitler was not to be balked. In August 1939, when general mobilization went ahead, OKW consisted of the Office of the Chief of Staff, Keitel, a Central Administrative Division, the Armed Forces Administration Office, under Jodl, which kept Hitler informed of the military situation, an intelligence office under Admiral Wilhelm Canaris, a war production office, and various smaller units concerned with military justice and finance. According to Plan White, on either side of a relatively weak and stationary center, two powerful wings of the Wehrmacht would envelop Poland, crush its armed forces, and capture Warsaw. Army Group North, under Colonel General Fedor von Bock, would smash through the Polish corridor, take Danzig, present-day Gdansk, unite with the German Third Army in East Prussia, and move swiftly to attack the Polish capital from the north. Meanwhile, an even stronger army group south, under Colonel General Gerd von Rundstedt, would punch between the larger Polish forces facing it, push east all the way to Lwów, but also assault Warsaw from the west and north. At the Jablunka Pass, the Poles did at least destroy the railway tunnel, which was not reopened until 1948. The Polish corridor, which had been intended by the framers of the Versailles Treaty of 1919 to cut off East Prussia from the rest of Germany, had long been presented as a casus belli by the Nazis, as had the ethnically German Baltic port of Danzig. But as Hitler had told a conference of generals in May 1939, Danzig is not the real issue. The real point is for us to open up our Lebensraum to the east and ensure our supplies of foodstuffs. Yet much more than mere practicalities drove Hitler. This was to be an existential conflict, fulfilling the prophecies he'd made 14 years before in his political testimony, Mein Kampf. The German master race would subjugate the Slavs, Untermenschen, subhumans, according to Nazi precepts of racial hierarchy, and use their territory to nurture a new Aryan civilization. This was to be the world's first wholly political ideological war. And it is a contention of this book that that was the primary reason why the Nazis eventually lost it. The strategy of having a weak center and two powerful flanks was a brilliant one, and was believed to have derived from Field Marshal Count Alfred von Schlieffen's celebrated pre-Great War study of Hannibal's tactics at the Battle of Cannae. Whatever the provenance, it worked well, slipping German armies neatly between Polish ones and enabling them to converge on Warsaw from different angles almost simultaneously. Yet what made it irresistible was not a German preponderance in men and arms, but above all, the new military doctrine of blitzkrieg. Poland was a fine testing ground for blitzkrieg tactics. Although it had lakes, forests, and bad roads, it was nonetheless flat, with immensely wide fronts and firm late-summer ground ideal for tanks. Because the British and French governments, fearful that Germany was about to invade at any moment, had given their guarantee to Poland on the 1st of April 1939, with the British Prime Minister, Neville Chamberlain, formally promising her all support in the power of the Allies should she be attacked, Hitler was forced to leave a large proportion of his 100 Division Army in the west, guarding the Siegfried Line, or West Wall, a three-mile-deep series of still incomplete fortifications along Germany's western frontier. The fear of war on two fronts led the Führer to detail no fewer than 40 divisions to protect his back. However, three-quarters of these were only second-rate units, and they'd been left with only 3 days ammunition. His best troops, along with all his armoured and mobile divisions and almost all his aircraft, Hitler devoted to the attack on Poland. Plan White was drawn up by the OKH planners, with Hitler merely putting his imprimatur on the final document. At this early stage of the war, there was a good deal of genuine mutual respect between Hitler and his generals, aided by the fact that he'd not so far interfered too closely in their troop dispositions and planning. His two Iron Crosses gave him some standing with his generals. Hitler's own self-confidence in military affairs was singular. This may have come in part from the sense of superiority of many veteran infantrymen, that it was they who had borne the brunt of the fighting in the Great War. Both the OKW chief of staff, Wilhelm Keitel, and his lieutenant, the chief of the Wehrmacht operations staff, Alfred Jodl, had been artillerymen and staff officers in the Great War. Their battle had been an indirect one, although Keitel had been wounded. General Walter von Reichenau, Colonel General Walter von Brauchitsch, and General Hans von Kluge were also artillerymen. And General Paul von Kleist and Lieutenant General Erich Manstein had been in the cavalry, although Manstein too had been wounded. Some generals, such as Heinz Guderian, had been in signals, and others, such as Maximilian von Weichs, had spent most of the war on the general staff. Whatever the reason, Hitler was not as cowed as an ex-corporal would usually have been among generals. Although he'd been a mere Meldegänger, he would also have learnt something about tactics. It is possible that had Hitler been a German citizen, he would have been commissioned. Knowing this himself, he might well have emerged from the war with a sense of being capable of commanding a battalion, which only a technicality had prevented. Many of the generals of 1939 had spent the 1920s in the paramilitary militia known as the Freikorps, and the tiny treaty army that was permitted under Versailles. Before Hitler came to power, this had involved little more than staff work, training, and studying. That would not have overly impressed Hitler, whatever titular rank those serving in it had achieved. For all that former Lieutenant Colonel Winston Churchill was to mock Corporal Hitler for his lowly Great War rank in the trenches, the Führer seems to have been under no inferiority complex when dealing directly with soldiers who had widely outranked him in the previous conflict. Plan White devoted 60 divisions to the conquest of Poland, including 5 panzer divisions of 300 tanks each, 4 light divisions of fewer tanks and some horses, and 4 fully motorized divisions with lorry-borne infantry, as well as 3,600 operational aircraft and much of the powerful Kriegsmarine, German Navy. Poland, meanwhile, had only 30 infantry divisions, 11 cavalry brigades, 2 mechanized brigades, 300 medium and light tanks, 1,154 field guns, and 400 aircraft ready for combat, of which only 36 Losch aircraft were not obsolete, as well as a fleet of only 4 modern destroyers and 5 submarines. Although these forces comprised fewer than 1 million men, Poland tried to mobilize her reservists, but that was far from complete when the devastating blow fell from 630,000 German troops under Bock and 886,000 under Rundstedt. As dawn broke on the 1st of September, Heinkel HE-111 bombers, with top speeds of 350 kilometers per hour, carrying 2,000 kilogram loads, as well as Dorniers and Junkers Ju-87 Stuka dive bombers, began pounding Polish roads, airfields, railway junctions, munition dumps, mobilization centers, and cities, including Warsaw. Meanwhile, the training ship Schleswig-Holstein in Danzig harbour started shelling the Polish garrison at Westerplatte. The Stukas had special sirens attached, whose screams hugely intensified the terror of those below. Much of the Polish Air Force was destroyed on the ground, and air superiority, which was to be a vital factor in this 6-year conflict, was quickly won by the Luftwaffe. The Messerschmitt ME-109 had a top speed of 470 kilometers per hour, and the far slower Polish planes stood little chance, however brave their pilots. Furthermore, Polish anti-aircraft defences, where there were any, were inadequate. In charge of the 2 armoured divisions and 2 light divisions of Army Group North was General Heinz Guderian, a long-time exponent of, indeed, passionate proselytizer for the tactics of Blitzkrieg. Wielding his force as an homogeneous entity, by contrast with Army Group South, where tanks were split up among different units, Guderian scored amazing successes as he raced ahead of the main body of the infantry. Polish retaliation was further hampered by vast numbers of refugees taking to the roads. Once they were bombed and machine-gunned from the air, in further pursuance of blitzkrieg tactics, chaos ensued. Hitler needed the Polish campaign to be over quickly in case of an attack in the west. But it was not until 11 a.m. on Sunday, the 3rd of September, that Neville Chamberlain's government finally declared war on Germany, with the French government reluctantly following 6 hours later. It soon became clear to everyone, except the ever-hopeful Poles, that the Western Allies were not about to assault the Siegfried Line, even though the French had 85 divisions there facing 40 German. A fear of massive German air attacks devastating London and Paris partly explained Allied inaction, but even if Britain and France had attacked in the West, Poland could probably not have been saved in time. As it was, although the RAF, Advanced Air Striking Force, reached France by the 9th of September, the main British Expeditionary Force, BEF, under Lord Gort VC, did not start to arrive on the continent until the next day. What was not appreciated by the Allies at the time was the ever-present fear that Hitler had of an attack from the West while he was dealing with matters in the East. In a letter to the deputy prison governor at Nuremberg in 1946, Wilhelm Keitel averred that what the Führer most feared and repeatedly brought up was firstly the possibility of a secret agreement between the French and Belgian general staffs for a surprise thrust by the French high-speed motorized forces through Belgium and over the German frontier, so as to burst into the German industrialized zone in the Ruhr, and secondly, the possibility of a secret agreement between the British Admiralty and the Dutch General Staff for a surprise landing of British troops in Holland for an attack on the German north flank. In the event, Hitler needn't have worried about either development, as neither France nor Britain, let alone neutral Belgium and Holland, were so much as contemplating anything so imaginative and vigorous. It was true that Chamberlain brought the long-term anti-Nazi prophet Winston Churchill into his government as First Lord of the Admiralty, with political responsibility for the Royal Navy, but that was going to be Britain's most bellicose act for the moment. Except for one unsuccessful bombing raid on Wilhelmshaven naval base, and the dropping of 12 million leaflets on Germany, urging her people to overthrow their warmongering Führer. It was unlikely that this would happen, just as he was about to pull off one of Germany's greatest victories. German propaganda, controlled by Dr. Josef Goebbels, a man who fully deserves the cliché evil genius, had long claimed that the Reich had a fifth column of supporters inside Poland, further adding to the atmosphere of terror and mistrust there. It was to be a tactic used often in the future, although on this occasion it was to lead to around 7,000 ethnic Germans being massacred by their Polish neighbours and retreating Polish troops. This baleful aspect of racial total war was to be acted out on a monstrous scale across the continent. But while on this occasion the Poles did it from terror of betrayal, soon the Nazis were to respond in cold blood and on a far, far larger scale. By the 5th of September, the Polish corridor was cut off entirely. The Polish Pomerze Army was encircled in the north by the 8th of September, and the German 10th Army, under General Walter von Reichenau, and the 8th Army, under General Johannes Blaskowitz, had soon broken over and around the Polish Krakow and Lodz armies by the 17th. The Polish government fled first to Lublin and thence to Romania, where they were initially welcomed, but then, under pressure from Hitler, interned. On the night of the 6th of September, France invaded Germany. At least, technically. Hoping to give the Poles some respite, the French commander-in-chief, General Maurice Gamelin, ordered an advance 5 miles into the Saarland along a 15-mile-wide front, capturing a dozen abandoned German villages. The Germans retreated behind the defences of the Siegfried Line and waited. As France was still mobilising, no further action was taken, and 5 days later the French returned to their original positions with orders simply to undertake reconnaissance work. It was hardly all support in the power of the Allies, and there is no evidence that Hitler removed a single man from the east to counter it. On the 8th of September, Reichenau's 10th Army reached the outskirts of Warsaw, but was initially repulsed by fierce Polish resistance. Despite years of threats by Hitler, the Poles had not built extensive fixed defences, preferring to rely on counterattacks. This all changed in early September when the city centre of Warsaw witnessed makeshift barricades being thrown up, anti-tank ditches dug, and turpentine barrels made ready for ignition. Hitler's plan was to seize Warsaw before the US Congress met on the 21st of September, so as to present it and the world with a fait accompli. But that was not quite to happen.
"The Polish army will never emerge again from the German embrace," predicted Hermann Göring on the 9th of September.
Until then, the Germans had operated a textbook attack. But that night, General Tadeusz Kutrzeba of the Poznan army took over the Pomorze army and crossed the Bzura River in a brilliant attack against the flank of the German 8th Army, launching the three-day Battle of Kutno, which incapacitated an entire German division. Only when the panzers of the 10th Army returned from besieging Warsaw were the Poles forced back. According to German and Italian propaganda, some Polish cavalry charged German tanks armed only with lances and sabres, but this did not, in fact, happen at all. Nonetheless, as Melantin observed, "All the dash and bravery which the Poles frequently displayed could not compensate for a lack of modern arms and serious tactical training." By contrast, the Wehrmacht training was completely modern and impressively flexible. Some troops could even perform in tanks, as infantry and as artillerymen, while all German NCOs were trained to serve as officers if the occasion demanded. Of course, it helped enormously that the Germans were the aggressors and so knew when the war was going to start. In 1944, the Guards officer and future military historian Michael Howard went on a course, learning everything that was to be known about the German army, its organisation, uniforms, doctrine, personnel, tactics, weapons, everything except why it was so bloody good. Part of the answer goes back to the way that the Junker state of Prussia in the 17th century had allowed bright middle-class youths to win advancement in the Prussian army. Voltaire said, "Where some states have an army, the Prussian army has a state." And his contemporary, the Comte de Mirabeau, agreed, quipping that, "War is the national industry of Prussia." Status, respect, and prestige attached to officers in uniform. The lesson of the great national revival of 1813 was discipline, and it was not forgotten, even in the defeat of 1918. Hindenburg, even though a defeated general, was elected president. The Germans were fighting their fifth war of aggression in 75 years, and as Howard also records, when it came to digging deep slit trenches or aiming howitzers, they were simply better than the Allies. Blitzkrieg required extraordinarily close cooperation between the services, and the Germans achieved it triumphantly. It took the Allies half a war to catch up. With only three Polish divisions covering the 800-mile-long eastern border, it came as a complete surprise when at dawn on the 17th of September, the USSR invaded Poland, in accordance with secret clauses of the Nazi-Soviet pact that had been agreed on the 24th of August. The Russians wanted revenge for their defeats at Poland's hands in 1920, access to the Baltic states, and a buffer zone against Germany, and they opportunistically grasped all three without any significant resistance. Their total losses amounted to only 734 killed. Stalin used Polish colonialism in the Ukraine and Belorussia as his gossamer thin causus belli, arguing that the Red Army had invaded Poland in order to restore peace and order. The Poles were thus doubly martyred, smashed between the Nazi hammer and the Soviet anvil, and were not to regain their independence and freedom until November 1989, half a century later. In one of the most despicable acts of naked viciousness of the war, in the spring of 1940, the Red Army transported 4,100 Polish officers, who had surrendered to them under the terms of the Geneva Convention, to a forest near Smolensk called Kachin, where they were each shot in the back of the head. Vasily Blokhin, chief executioner of the Russian Secret Service, the NKVD, led the squad responsible, wearing leather overalls and an apron and long leather gloves to protect his uniform from the blood and brains, and using a German Walter pistol because it did not jam when it got hot from repeated use. Nonetheless, he complained he got blisters on his trigger finger by the end of the third day of continuous executions. In all, 21,857 Polish soldiers were executed by the Soviets at Kachin and elsewhere, an operation which, after the Germans had invaded Russia, Stalin's police chief, Lavrenty Beria, admitted had been a mistake. When the Germans uncovered the mass graves on the 17th of April 1943, Goebbels broadcast the Kachin massacre to the world. But Soviet propaganda had made out that it had been undertaken by the Nazis themselves, a lie that was knowingly colluded in by the British Foreign Office until as late as 1972, even though charges against the Germans over Kachin were dropped at the Nuremberg trials. Because, by mid-September, the Germans had already moved into several areas behind Warsaw, and had indeed taken Brest-Litovsk and Lvov, some fighting inadvertently broke out between Russians and Germans, with two Cossacks killed in one incident and 15 Germans in another. Ribbentrop, the German foreign minister, flew to Moscow in order to agree the lines of demarcation. And after an evening at the Bolshoi watching Swan Lake, and tough negotiations with his Russian counterpart Molotov lasting until 5 o'clock the next morning, it was agreed that the Germans would get Warsaw and Lublin, and the Russians the rest of eastern Poland and a free hand in the Baltic. The Germans withdrew from towns such as Brest-Litovsk and Bialystok in the new Russian sector, and the fourth partition in Poland's history was effectively complete. Molotov would have done well, however, to take note of Hitler's statement made many years before in Mein Kampf. Let no one argue that in concluding an alliance with Russia, we need not immediately think of war, or, if we did, that we could thoroughly prepare for it. An alliance whose aim does not embrace a plan for war is senseless and worthless. Alliances are concluded only for struggle. After a full day of bombing on the 25th of September, with no prospect of meaningful help from the Western Allies, a full-scale assault from the Russians in the east, communications cut between Smigli Rietz and much of his army, and with food and medical supplies running dangerously low, Warsaw capitulated on the 27th. It was then 3 days before the Germans agreed to help the wounded in the city, by which time for many it was too late. Field kitchens were set up only for as long as the newsreel cameras were there. By the 5th of October, all resistance had ended. 217,000 Polish soldiers passed into Russian captivity and 693,000 into German. Fortunately, between 90,000 and 100,000 managed to escape the country via Lithuania, Hungary and Romania, to make their way westwards and join the Free Polish Forces under General Władysław Sikorski, the Prime Minister in exile, who was in Paris when the war broke out, and who set up a government in exile in Angers in France. About 100,000 Poles in the Russian sector, aristocrats, intellectuals, trade unionists, churchmen, politicians, veterans of the 1920-21 Russo-Polish War, indeed anyone who might form the nucleus of a new national leadership, were arrested by the NKVD and sent to concentration camps, from which virtually none emerged. In the four-week campaign, the Germans had lost 8,082 killed and 27,278 wounded, whereas 70,000 Polish soldiers and 25,000 civilians had been killed and 130,000 soldiers wounded. "The operations were of considerable value in blooding our troops," concluded Melantin, "and teaching them the difference between real war with live ammunition and peacetime manoeuvres." It had indeed been lightning war. And on the 5th of October, a triumphant Adolf Hitler travelled to Warsaw in his special train, for some reason named America, to visit his victorious troops. "Take a good look around Warsaw," he told the war correspondents there. "That is how I can deal with any European city." It was true. What was to be called the policy of Schrecklichkeit, frightfulness, had begun as soon as the Germans had entered Poland. For the master race to have their living space, large numbers of Slavic and Jewish Untermenschen had to disappear. And during the war, Poland lost a staggering 17.2% of her population. The commander of three Totenkopf Death's Head SS regiments, Theodor Eicher, ordered his men to incarcerate or annihilate every enemy of National Socialism that they found as they followed the troops into Poland. Since Nazism was a racial and political ideology, that meant that huge swathes of the Polish people were automatically classed as enemies, to whom no mercy could be shown. The Wehrmacht took active part in the violence. The country was handed over to a civilian administration on the 26th of October, only 8 weeks after war broke out. But by then the German army had, without special orders needing to be given, burnt 531 towns and villages and killed thousands of Polish POWs. The claim made by many German soldiers to Allied re-education officers, and to each other, that they had been simple soldiers who had known nothing of the genocide against the Slavs and the Jews, or at best had heard only rumours, was a lie. The Schutzstaffel, Defence Unit, or SS, was originally the protective guard of the National Socialist Party. It was formally described as an independent Gliederung formation of the party, led by Reichsführer SS, chief of the SS, Heinrich Himmler. Yet by the time of the outbreak of war, it had grown, and by 1944 could be described accurately by an Allied briefing book as a state within a state, superior both to the party and the government. Officially described after Hitler came to power as protecting the internal security of the Reich, the SS revelled in the terror its ruthlessness and cruelty inspired. "I know that there are millions in Germany who sicken at the sight of the black uniforms of our SS," wrote Himmler in a brochure for his organization entitled Die Schutzstaffeln in 1936. "We understand that well, and we do not expect to be loved by too many." From the early days, when it provided the bodyguards for Nazi street and beer hall speakers, the SS grew, especially after it wiped out the leadership of its rival, the SA, into an organization that was intimately involved in many aspects of the state. As well as providing the Führer's most personal selected guard, the SS promoted the doctrine of race and blood, dominated the police force, set up a military section, the Waffen-SS, numbering 830,000 by 1945, which fought in every campaign except Norway and Africa, and the Totenkopfverbände, a self-contained entity which ran the concentration and extermination camps, ruled the state security service, the Sicherheitsdienst, SD, and had its own depots and notoriously tough training establishments, as well as having departments covering economics, supply, works and building, finance, legal affairs, industrial and agricultural undertakings, medical matters, personnel, racial quality, the family, resettlement, discipline, camp construction, the regions, liaison, pardons and reprieves, The strengthening of Germanism, signals and communications, education, folk schools, and the repatriation of racial Germans. These SS entities were quite separate from the rest of the German state. Hitler devised their motto, Mein Ehre heißt Treue, my honour is loyalty, in 1931, neatly encapsulating his need to have a force that he could trust to put allegiance to him before any system of morality. The nature of their operations became immediately apparent. On the 5th of September 1939, 1,000 civilians were shot by the SS at Bydgoszcz, and at Piotrków, the Jewish district was torched. The next day, 19 Polish officers who had surrendered were shot at Mirochna. Meanwhile, the entire Jewish population began to be herded into ghettos across Poland. This happened even to Jewish farmers, despite the pressing need for efficient food production in the new eastern satrapy of the Third Reich. Early evidence that the Nazis would be willing to put their war against the Jews even before their war against the Allies. On the Day of Atonement, the holiest day in their calendar, thousands of Jews were locked into the synagogue at Bydgoszcz and refused access to lavatories, forcing them to use their prayer shawls to clean themselves. Worse was to come. Both the Nazi-Soviet Pact of the 24th of August 1939 and its coda in Moscow the following month gave Stalin a completely free hand in the north, and he moved swiftly to capitalize on it. Hoping to protect Leningrad against any future German attack, he tried to turn the Gulf of Finland into a Soviet seaway, even though its northern shore was Finnish and most of its southern shore Estonian. Latvia, Lithuania, and Estonia were bullied into agreements that allowed the Red Army to be stationed at key points on their territory. And in June 1940, their sovereignty was extinguished altogether by effective annexation. Surrounded on three sides by mighty Russia, they had no real choice but to acquiesce. Finland was another matter. Even though she had a tiny fraction of Russia's population and an 800-mile border with her. In October, Stalin summoned the Finns to Moscow to be presented with Soviet demands. They sent the leader of the Social Democrat Party, Väinö Tanner, who has been described as tough, tactless, stubborn, and frequently bloody-minded. A curious choice of representative when the survival of one's nation was at stake. Meanwhile, they mobilized. Stalin and Molotov wanted a 30-year lease on the naval base of Cape Hanko, the cession of the Arctic port of Petsamo, and three small islands in the Gulf, as well as the moving back of the frontier on the Karelian Isthmus, which was presently only 15 miles from Leningrad. In return for these 1,066 square miles of territory, the Russians were willing to give Finland 2,134 square miles of Russian Karelia around Repola and Porajorpi. On the face of it, the deal did not look unreasonable. But when considered strategically, the key nodal points the Bolshevik leaders were demanding made it clear that Finnish sovereignty would be hopelessly compromised. And the Finns decided to fight rather than submit. Matters were not helped when Tanner mentioned his and Stalin's supposedly shared Menshevik past, a libel on the Bolshevik leader. On the 28th of November, the USSR abrogated its 1932 non-aggression treaty with Finland. And 2 days later, without declaring war, the Russians bombed Helsinki and invaded Finland with 1.2 million men, opening a bitter 105-day struggle that some have likened to the Spartan stand at Thermopylae. The world prepared to watch another small nation being crushed by a totalitarian monolith. The Finnish army comprised 10 divisions, with only 36 artillery pieces per division, all of pre-1918 vintage, and inadequate small arms, although they did have the excellent 9mm Suomi machine pistol, supported by few modern aircraft. They lacked everything, one historian has noted, except courage and discipline.
The Russians, by contrast, came across the border with 1,500 tanks, 3,000 aircraft, and a complete assumption of a quick victory, as in Poland. The Red Army divided its attack into four parts. The 7th and 13th armies would smash through the Finnish defences on the Karelian Isthmus, known as the Mannerheim Line, and capture Viipuri, Viborg, the second city of Finland. Meanwhile, the 8th Army would march round the northern shore of Lake Lagoda to fall on Viipuri from the north. The 9th Army would attack the waste of Finland, slicing it in two, and in the far north, the 14th Army would capture Petsamo and Nootsi, cutting the country off from the Arctic Sea. The comprehensiveness of the plan has been described by one military historian as imaginative, flexible, and totally unrealistic. Although the 14th Army took its objectives in the first 10 days, nothing else went right for the Russians for the next 2 months. The 7th Army, comprising 12 divisions, 3 tank brigades, and a mechanized corps, could not break through the wilderness of barbed wire, gun emplacements, anti-tank dragon's teeth, and well-camouflaged pillboxes of the Mannerheim Line, which was fiercely defended. The frozen ground was so hard that the Red Army occasionally had to use dynamite to move enough earth to build makeshift trenches. Even though the Finns had never faced tanks before and were woefully under-equipped with anti-tank weapons, at least until they captured them from the Russians, they devised makeshift ways of stopping their advance, including, ironically enough, Molotov cocktails, bottles of petrol lit with rags. This proved easier in the early stages when Russian tanks were not supported closely enough by Russian infantry, and in the dark that descended early in the Arctic winter and stayed till late. The 72-year-old defender of Finland, after whom the line was named, Field Marshal Baron Karl von Mannerheim, proved an inspired leader throughout the campaign, keeping his reserves in the south and correctly predicting the Russians' next moves, possibly because he'd been an officer in the Tsarist army throughout the Great War. Told by Moscow that the Finnish proletariat would welcome them as liberators, the Russian soldiers were shocked when the entire nation united behind the defender of Finland instead. It was the 5 divisions of the Russian 9th Army in the centre of the country that suffered the most. Although on the map the vast wastes might seem to favour an invader, the many forests and lakes channeled the Russian forces, unfamiliar with the terrain, into a series of ambushes as temperatures dipped in that unusually cold winter to as low as minus 50 Celsius. The Leningrad-Murmansk railway line had only one siding going off towards the Finnish border. And although the Russians took Salla in central Finland, they were flung back before they reached Kemijärvi. The Finns burnt their own farms and villages, booby-trapped farm animals, destroyed anything that could provide the Russians with food and shelter, and, equipped with skis and local knowledge, laid mines on tracks through the forests that were soon covered in snow. Wearing white camouflage uniforms, which inexplicably the Russians were not given, the Finns were nicknamed Bielia Smet, White Death, by their bewildered enemy. Further south, the Russian 163rd and 44th Divisions were annihilated around the ashes of the village of Suomussalmi in a ferociously brilliant Finnish operation that ranks with any of the Second World War. A logging, fishing and hunting community of 4,000 people before the war, it was captured by the 163rd Tula Motorized Rifle Division on the 9th of December, but was then cut off by the Finnish 9th Brigade under Colonel Jalmar Silasvou. Because their leaders had assumed an easy victory, many of the Russians had been sent into subarctic Finland in December, lacking winter clothes and felt boots. As the Finns discovered by listening to their radio transmissions, which were equally astonishingly sent en clair rather than in code. Freezing, starving, and cut off from retreat by the Finnish 9th Brigade for a fortnight, the morale of the 163rd Division broke on Christmas Eve, and they fled eastwards across the frozen Lake Kyantajärvi. The Finns then sent up 2 Bristol Blenheim medium bombers to smash the ice,
sending tanks, horses, men and vehicles tumbling into the freezing water below. As the historian of the Russo-Finnish Winter War laconically records, they are still there. The Russian 44th Division that had come to rescue the 163rd were within earshot of the debacle and could hear their comrades dying, but they were not given orders to move. On the night of New Year's Day, they became the next victims of the White Death as the barometer dipped again to minus 30 Celsius. By constantly mortar-bombing their 60 field kitchens at mealtimes, the Finns kept the Russians short of hot food. And when the Russians lit fires, the Finns machine-gunned them from the treetops, easily picking out the dark silhouettes of the men against the snow. The standard Red Army rifle, the single-shot, bolt-action 7.62mm 1902 Moisin Nagant, became inoperable when its gun oil lubricant froze in conditions below minus 15 Celsius. And armoured vehicles either had to be kept running at ruinous expense in fuel, or they would seize up and block the narrow passages through the forest. "We don't let them rest," said General Kurt Valenius of the Finnish Northern Army. "We don't let them sleep. This is a war of numbers against brains." Sleep for the 44th was next to impossible because of the vehicle engines, terrified horses, Finnish professional trackers and hunters who made excellent snipers, and even the sharp reports of the trees as their very sap froze. Those who resorted to vodka found that, despite the initial sense of warmth, body heat was ultimately lost. The slightest wounds exposed to the air froze and went gangrenous. Frozen corpses were piled up, one on top of the other, as the Finns methodically moved from sector to sector, wiping out Russian resistance. By the 5th of January, 1,000 Russian prisoners had been taken, a further 700 soldiers had escaped back to the Russian lines, and over 27,000 had been killed, all for the loss of 900 Finns. As one of his officers remarked to Colonel Cialasalvo, "The wolves will eat well this winter." The Finns captured 42 tanks, 102 field guns, and 300 vehicles at Suomussalmi, as well as thousands of the conical-shaped Red Army hats, Budenovka, that they later used in deception operations. Indeed, they captured more military hardware than they received from outside sources, however much the League of Nations supported Finland's struggle, expelling the USSR from its ranks on the 14th of December, and however much the Western Allies' Supreme War Council debated sending aid. They agreed to it only on the 5th of February, by which time it was too late. The loss of the two divisions at Suomussalmi, when compounded with the reversals at the Mannerheim line and the victory of General Pavlo Talvela, who destroyed the 139th and 75th Red Army divisions at Tolvajärvi on Christmas Eve, sent a humiliating message around the globe for the USSR. Even though the Finns could not follow up these successes for lack of troops, they were conscripting 15-year-olds as it was. Hitler in particular believed that he learnt lessons about the performance of the Red Army that were to affect his decision to invade Russia the following year. Yet they were substantially the wrong ones. Stalin's purging of the officer corps in 1937 had seriously weakened the Red Army. The former chief of staff, Marshal Tukhachevsky, was shot, and with him died new thinking about the development of mass armoured formations operating deep inside enemy territory. General Konstantin Rokossovsky, one of those who were tortured during that time, though not shot despite his Polish origins, later said that purges were even worse for morale than when artillery fired on one's own troops, because it would have had to have been very accurate artillery fire to achieve such damage. Three out of the five Soviet marshals were purged in 1937-38. 13 of the 15 army commanders, 57 of the 85 corps commanders, 110 of the 195 divisional commanders, and 220 of the 406 brigade commanders. In total, around 43,000 officers were killed or imprisoned, although 20,000 were later released. Yet no fewer than 71 out of the original 85 senior members of the USSR's military council were dead by 1941. When Rokossovsky, who'd been beaten so badly in prison that he lost 8 teeth and had 3 ribs broken, reported to Stalin for duty after being reinstated, Stalin asked him where he'd been. Rokossovsky told him, whereupon Stalin laughed and said, "A fine time you chose to go to prison," before getting down to business. Although the Soviet forces were staggeringly badly led at the outset of the Winter War, they learnt quickly. A trusted member of the Supreme Soviet from its creation in 1937, General Semyon Timoshenko was sent to take over on the 8th of January, and after 4 or 5 attacks a day, he broke through the Mannerheim line on the 13th of February. In Finland, the Soviets came to understand the importance of coordinating armour, infantry and artillery. However heavy the Russian losses, there were always fresh troops to fling into the struggle. As one Finn put it after the Battle of Kumo, "There were more Russians than we had bullets." When the fighting became purely attritional on the isthmus, the Finns simply could not carry on bleeding like the Russians could. Furthermore, the Winter War showed that men fought harder when patriotically defending the Soviet motherland than when in attack. That was eventually to apply to the German fatherland too. Instead of these lessons, Hitler learnt the almost banal one that Stalin had shot a lot of good generals in the late 1930s. He was not the only one, however. On the 20th of January 1940, Churchill said that Finland had exposed, for all to see, the incapacity of the Red Army. On the 11th of February, the Russian 123rd Division broke through the Mannerheim line close to Suma, leading much of the 7th Army through 2 days later. Then they moved on to Vipuri. With neutral Norway and Sweden denying access across their territory to the Allies, Petsamo in Russian hands and Hitler closing off the eastern Baltic, no significant help was likely from the West. Since by March, as much as 1/5 of his army had become casualties, and there were only 100 Finnish planes left to fight 800 Russians, Mannerheim urged the government to negotiate, and the Treaty of Moscow was signed on the 13th of March, while Russian and Finnish troops were still engaged in hand-to-hand combat in central Vipuri. Except for the loss of the whole Karelian isthmus, the terms were not very much worse from those demanded by Stalin and Molotov in November, before around 200,000 Russians and 25,000 Finns had died, and 680 Russian aircraft and 67 Finnish had been destroyed. Yet Russian military prestige had been severely damaged, and Stalin had created a situation on his northwestern border that would require 15 divisions to police. The moment that Finland sniffed her opportunity for revenge, at the time of Operation Barbarossa in June 1941, she seized it. The 6-month hiatus on land between the end of the Polish campaign in October 1939 and Hitler's sudden invasion of Denmark and Norway on the 9th of April 1940 is known as the Phony War. With little going on in the West, on land and in the skies, the British and French publics were lulled into thinking that the war was not truly a matter of life and death for them, in the way that it obviously was for the Poles, and their daily existence was carried on substantially as usual, in all its bureaucracy, inefficiency, and occasional absurdity. The National Labour MP, Harold Nicholson, recorded in his war diaries that the Ministry of Information Censors had refused to publish the wording of a leaflet, of which 2 million copies had been dropped over Germany, on the grounds that,
We are not allowed to disclose information that might be of value to the enemy.
There was nothing phony about the war at sea, however. It was perfectly true that the British Air Minister, Sir Kingsley Wood, made the asinine remark that the RAF should not bomb munitions dumps in the Black Forest because so much of it was private property. But at sea, no such absurdities pertained. As early as the 19th of August, U-boat captains were sent a seemingly anodyne signal about the scheduling of a submarine officers' reunion, which was the coded order to take up the positions around the British Isles in readiness for imminent action. Within 9 hours of the declaration of war, the 1,400 passengers aboard a blacked-out British liner, SS Athenia, were torpedoed on their way from Glasgow to Montreal by U-30, whose captain mistook the ship for an armed merchant cruiser.
"There was a column of water near the ship," recalled a Czech survivor, "and a black thing like a cigar shot over the sea towards us. There was a bang, and then I saw men on the submarine turn a gun and fire it."
Had they hit the radio mast and the SOS signal not been transmitted, many more than 112 passengers would have perished. The first of hundreds of Atlantic convoys left Halifax, Nova Scotia, on the 15th of September, 1939. Learning the doleful lessons of the Great War, the convoy system was adhered to rigidly by the British between 1939 and 1945, even for ships moving along the coastline between Glasgow and the Thames. Destroyers, frigates and corvettes used an echo-sounding device called ASDIC, named after the Allied Submarine Detection Investigation Committee, to try to track U-boats, while the convoy's merchantmen sailed together within a protective cordon. They also adopted a zigzagging route, the better to outfox their submerged foes. Overall, the system was a success, but when a waiting U-boat wolf pack broke through, the losses among the huddled merchantmen could be correspondingly high, and on occasion, as many as half of the vessels were sent to the bottom. The Royal Navy started the war with only 5 aircraft carriers, and on the 17th of September, the veteran, HMS Courageous, was sunk in the western approaches by 2 torpedoes from U-29, which had already dispatched 3 tankers. She slipped beneath the Hebridean waves in less than 15 minutes, with only half of her 1,000-strong crew being saved, some after an hour in the North Sea, where they kept up morale by singing popular songs of the day such as "Roll Out the Barrel" and "Show Me the Way to Go Home." The sea, recalled a survivor, was so thick with oil we might have been swimming in treacle. The following month, the Kriegsmarine scored an almost equally spectacular success nearby, when Lieutenant Commander Gunter Prien's U-47 got through a 50-foot gap in the defences of Scarpa Flow and fired 7 torpedoes at the 29,000-ton battleship HMS Royal Oak. 3 hit, capsizing the ship and killing 810 of her 1,224 crew in only 13 minutes. One task of the U-boats was to place magnetic mines in the sea lanes around the British Isles. This could also be done by parachute, by low-flying Heinkel HE-111s, and by E-boats, motor torpedo boats, and destroyers. By the end of November, these had sunk 29 British ships, including the destroyer HMS Gypsy, and had also put the brand-new cruiser HMS Belfast out of action for 3 years. Through the immense bravery of bomb disposal experts, Lieutenant Commanders R.C. Lewis and J.G.D. Ouvry, who removed the 2 detonators, one of which was ticking audibly, from a mine spotted in the Thames estuary, the secrets of the steel hull-activated device were discovered. Within a month, Admiralty scientists had discovered a way of counteracting the mines by fitting electric cables around ships' hulls to create a negative magnetic or degaussed field. Soon afterwards, a means of blowing up the mines, using wooden-hulled trawlers towing buoyant electric cables, was also invented. It was the spotting, disabling, and eventual forced scuttling of the German pocket battleship, the Admiral Graf Spee, that was the Royal Navy's greatest victory during the so-called phony war. Operating off South America, Captain Hans Langsdorff had sunk 10 ships, totaling more than 50,000 tons. The term pocket battleship is somewhat misleading. Although a limit of 10,000 tons had been imposed on German warships by the Versailles Treaty, once the Graf Spee was loaded up with her 6 8-inch, 8 5.9-inch, and 6 4.1-inch guns, as well as ammunition and stores, she weighed more than half as much again. In the Battle of the River Plate, on the 13th of December, she took on the 8-inch guns of the cruiser HMS Exeter, along with the 6-inch guns of the light cruisers HMS Ajax and the New Zealander-crewed HMS Achilles, badly damaging the first two ships. When the Graf Spee was forced into the harbour of Montevideo, capital of neutral Uruguay, on the 15th of December by the pounding she'd received, Langsdorff magnanimously released the Allied sailors he'd captured from the ships he'd sunk, who reported that they'd been well treated. Trusting to BBC radio broadcasts about the imminent arrival of the aircraft carrier HMS Ark Royal and the battlecruiser HMS Renown, and unable to hire a small plane to see whether this was in fact so, Langsdorff sailed the Graf Spee to the entrance of Montevideo Harbour just before dusk on Sunday the 17th of December and scuttled her. The explosions were watched by over 20,000 spectators on the shore and heard on the radio by millions around the world. In fact, only the cruiser HMS Cumberland had managed to reach Montevideo. The BBC had patriotically taken part in a giant bluff. 5 days later, Langsdorff shot himself. By the end of 1939, Britain had lost 422,000 tons of shipping, 260,000 by mines, against Germany's 224,000. But as a proportion of their total tonnages, Germany at 5% had lost more than Britain at 2%. In the naval war of attrition that this was going to be, the relative proportions were more important than the sheer overall tonnages. Had Hitler given first priority in terms of funding to his U-boat fleet on coming to power in 1933, rather than to the Wehrmacht and Luftwaffe, he might have built a force that would have strangled and starved Britain into surrender. Perhaps realizing this, on the 15th of February 1940, the Führer issued a directive to all U-boat captains stating that any ship, neutral or otherwise, sailing towards a British-controlled war zone, such as the English Channel, must be sunk without warning. For all the protests this new policy engendered from the neutral ship-owning countries such as Denmark, Sweden and Norway, it was, if anything, surprising that such orders had not been issued earlier. Besides, the level of respect that Germany felt for Scandinavian neutrality was to be spectacularly demonstrated only 3 weeks later. If Poland and Finland had merely demonstrated the impotence of Britain and France, with many Britons and Frenchmen concluding that the appeasing spirit of the 1930s had not been entirely expunged from their government's souls, the Norway campaign represented a definite defeat for the Western powers. Grand Admiral Erich Raeder urged Hitler as early as the 10th of October 1939 to consider invading Norway as a way of protecting the transportation of iron ore from the Gällivare mines in northern Sweden to Germany, and establishing U-boat bases along the fjords, especially at Trondheim. Hitler ordered the OKW to start planning for an invasion in late January 1940. At that point, Hitler did not want to divert troops from the attack he was planning in the west, and he was persuaded to do so only by signs that the Allies were planning to invade Norway themselves, possibly using aid for Finland as a cloak for their actions. An incident on the 16th of February, in which the neutral Norwegians seemed to have taken the Royal Navy's side when HMS Cossack daringly rescued 299 British prisoners from a German vessel, the Altmark, also persuaded the Führer of Norway's iniquity. Telling General Nikolaus von Falkenhorst, the commander of the corps which was to lead the expedition, that a British invasion of Norway
would lead them into the Baltic, where we have no troops nor coastal fortifications, and eventually to Berlin itself, Hitler decided to strike. In order to simplify lines of communication and prevent the Royal Navy operating in the Skagerrak and Kattegat Straits, Denmark would be invaded also. Although the Allies had lost any Finnish excuse for intervention in mid-March after the Treaty of Moscow was signed between Finland and the USSR, they did indeed plan to invade neutral Norway in order to deny the Gallivari ore fields to Germany, and had actually boarded troops at Scapa Flow, the Royal Navy's base in the Orkney Isles, in order to do so when the German attack began only 24 hours beforehand. The British military historian, Captain Basil Little Hart, later called the race to invade Norway a photo finish. Starting on the 8th of April, Allied planes dropped mines into the Norwegian Leads, the deep, sheltered waterway between the fjords and the islands along the coast from Stavanger to the Northern Cape, hoping to force German ore ships out into the Norwegian Sea, where the Royal Navy could sink them. Operation Wilfrid was a blatant incursion into Norwegian territorial waters that preceded Germany's own, and was to lead to the sinking of 20 Norwegian vessels, as well as 12 German ones. And when, at the end of the Nuremberg trials, Admiral Raeder was given a life sentence for, in part, violating Norway's neutrality, the hypocrisy led to accusations of victor's justice. The British Admiralty believed that with Britain's naval superiority in the Norwegian Sea, it was impossible for the Germans to effect an amphibious invasion of Norway, and so were caught utterly by surprise when at dawn, Tuesday the 9th of April, Operation Weser-Ubung, Weser Crossing, successfully landed troops, initially no more than 2,000 in each location, and soon secured Oslo, Kristiansand, Bergen, Trondheim and Narvik, the railway terminus for the Gallivari iron fields. It was one of the great coups of the Second World War. Paratroopers also captured Oslo and Stavanger airfields by daybreak. The British simply could not believe the news that a place as far north as Narvik, 1,200 miles from Germany, had fallen, thinking it must be a mistransmission of the name Larvik, a town near the mouth of the Oslo Fjord. The Norwegians, who at the time were concentrating more on the threat to their sovereignty from the Allies than on that from the Axis, were caught by surprise as much as anyone and had no time to mobilise. The Norwegian defence budget of the early 1930s was 35 million kroner, which had increased to only 50 million, 2.5 million pounds, by the time she was invaded. Her navy was entirely for coastal defence, and the army was small too. Employing only three divisions, although one of those was General Edward Dietl's crack 169th Mountain Division, but supported by 800 warplanes and 250 transport planes, the Germans had achieved every objective by the end of their first day. The hazy weather, intricate coastline, and German inter-service coordination and efficiency, as well as the considerable distances involved, meant that the Allies were unable to interdict the German operation. Bergen was taken by the light cruiser Köln, tricking its way into the harbour by using British radio signals. Two brave Norwegian coastal vessels fought back at Narvik, but were sunk. At Trondheim, the Admiral Hipper blinded coastal batteries with searchlights and destroyed one that managed to open fire. Off Bergen, the Luftwaffe's 10 Air Corps sank the destroyer HMS Gurkha and damaged the cruisers HMS Southampton and HMS Glasgow and the battleship HMS Rodney. Allied strategists took this, and the further battering the Royal Navy was to receive from the Luftwaffe during this campaign, as the foremost lesson of Norway, that power had tilted towards the air and away from the sea. With only one of its four active aircraft carriers, HMS Furious, in the region, and for reasons of time she'd sailed with her torpedo bombers on board but without her fighter squadron, the British could not match the Luftwaffe.
Although HMS Ark Royal and HMS Glorious were sent post-haste from Alexandria to assist the Allied counterattack, they didn't arrive until the 24th of April. The RAF never managed to deploy more than 100 planes during the campaign against more than 1,000 German, flying from aerodromes as close as Oslo and Stavanger. When the RAF did set up makeshift airfields in Norway, its planes had to be kept running around the clock and had to be refueled with jugs and buckets. The news that the two battlecruisers, Scharnhorst and Gneisenau, were supporting the operation in the Norwegian Sea also distracted Admiralty minds from the possibility of sinking smaller troop-carrying warships. The Allied response to Germany's invasion was swift enough, but haphazard and badly disorganized, and the plans changed more than once as they were being put into practice, with confusion and occasionally chaos resulting. The British troops who were embarked for the invasion of Norway had to be disembarked in Scotland so that the battlecruisers could be chased, leading one military historian to argue that the Admiralty saw the whole operation through blinkers. When they were later re-embarked for the counter-invasion, but without the correct equipment, a sense of incompetence began to attach itself to the campaign, which was only to get worse, and which was eventually to help bring down the Chamberlain government. Although on the 9th of April, artillery from the Oscarberg fortress near Oslo sank the cruiser Blücher, one of the very few victims of coastal guns during the Second World War, the Norwegian capital fell. It nonetheless gave King Haakon VII and his government time to escape and make a long, brave fighting retreat northwards, with the impressive Otto Ruger being appointed the new army chief of staff in the process. By contrast, King Christian X of Denmark had no opportunity to flee. As he woke up at 5:15 a.m. that day, he was handed a list of 13 ultimata by the German minister, soon to be plenipotentiary, Cecil von Rentefink. After the death of 12 Danes, and appreciating that his country was encircled and unable to resist in any meaningful way, he and the cabinet prevented a massacre by ordering a general surrender. A fiction was concocted by which it was announced that Denmark had agreed to place her neutrality under the protection of the Reich, a somewhat tautological construction, but one that allowed the country to retain her non-Nazi government. When the Führer's appeal to Denmark was about to be read over Danish radio, it was discovered that the appeal to Norway had been provided instead, one of the only inefficient aspects of the whole operation, so the announcer had to rewrite it hurriedly just before going on air. With Denmark's collapse in under 4 hours, the vital Aalborg airfield in North Jutland could now be used by the Luftwaffe to pour supplies and troops into Norway. It also meant that the Royal Navy could not enter the Skagerrak with anything other than submarines. The Royal Navy could punish the Kriegsmarine once it had landed the invasion force, and in two battles in the fjord off Narvik, on the 11th and 13th of April, no fewer than 9 German destroyers were sunk or put out of action, most of them by the battleship HMS Warspite. But the fear that Scharnhorst and Gneisenau were at Bergen or Trondheim meant that the chance of recapturing the ports early on was lost, even though, as it transpired, the German battlecruisers were not there. Instead, the Allies landed 125 miles north of Trondheim at Namsos on the night of the 18th of April, and 190 miles south of it at Andalsnes the same day, hoping to cross the snowy wastes in between and take it from the land. After being briefed on this operation at the Admiralty, its designated commander, Major General Frederick Hotblack, had a heart attack on the Duke of York's steps on the Mall on his way back to his club. His successor's plane then crashed on its way to Scotland. After the Allied force landed at Namsos under Major General Sir Adrian Carden de Weert, V.C., ceaselessly heavy pounding from Heikel bombers ended hopes that it might take Trondheim. The town was destroyed, the timber houses burned, the railhead and everything on it obliterated.
Electricity and water supplies were cut off. Even the wharves were wrecked, records one who was there. Namsos had ceased to exist. The bombing in the land of the midnight sun seemed to be round the clock and was demoralizing for the Allied troops, as was the fact that a French ship carrying skis, snowshoes, guns and tanks proved too large to get into the harbour. The one-handed, one-eyed, 60-year-old de Weert was one of the bravest British officers of the 20th century. Wounded during earlier wars in the ankle, hip, ear and leg, his body was a virtual scrap metal yard. He even had shrapnel lodged in his head that he said tickled every time his hair was cut. Yet even he saw no possibility of moving southwards without any RAF support. Namsos was evacuated on the 2nd of May, by which time the British force had already evacuated Undunsluys. Up at Narvik, the Allied force, which had landed at Harstad in the Lofoten Islands on the 14th of April, soon numbered 20,000, to the Germans, 4,000. Although inter-Allied cooperation worked well, relations between the British Army and Navy collapsed at Narvik because they were, incredibly enough, acting under contradictory instructions. Admiral of the Fleet, the Earl of Cork and Orrery, had been ordered to take Narvik whatever happened, whereas the commander of the land forces, Major General Pierce Mackesy, had been authorised to wait for the thaw before taking the town. While the Admiral and the General argued, and Mackesy tried to pull Cork out of the battle, German supplies reached the town, gun emplacements were built, and enemy morale soared. Mackesy, whose troops had inexplicably had their snowshoes offloaded in Scotland, had a point, however, as Cork discovered for himself when he went out to reconnoitre the position and slipped up to his waist in snow. These inter-service problems were soon dealt with, but reflected badly on the Chamberlain government at the time. Some fine Polish mountain troops, two battalions of the French Foreign Legion, and General Betoir, Chasseur Alpin, as well as the British and the Norwegians, were finally to take Narvik on the 27th of May, capturing a well-equipped airfield with wire mesh landing strips and camouflage shelters. However, after Hitler's victories in France and the Low Countries, such a tiny Scandinavian foothold was untenable, and the Narvik force was evacuated between the 2nd and 7th of June, along with the Norwegian royal family and government. But not Otto Ruger, who decided to stay with his men and was imprisoned. The Germans ran Norway directly until February 1942, when the Norwegian Nazi, Vidkun Quisling, was appointed minister-president and was permitted to run the most autonomous of all the Reich's puppet governments, because the Germans knew they could trust him ideologically. He had made his name as a humanitarian during the Russian famines and Armenian refugee crises of the 1920s, although his dreams of world federation under Nordic leadership never appealed to the Norwegian electorate, and his small National Samling party was only ever a marginal force in the 1930s. The Norwegians despised him throughout his period of rule, and had the court, trying him for high treason, somehow not imposed the death penalty upon him in 1945, his prison guards had agreed among themselves to murder him anyhow. On the 8th of June, Scharnhorst and Gneisenau intercepted the British aircraft carrier Glorious, carrying two squadrons of aircraft, including Hurricanes, and her escort destroyers Acasta and Ardent, and sank all three. Although not before the skipper of Acasta, Commander C.E. Glassford, had sailed his ship straight at the enemy and managed to launch a torpedo that damaged Scharnhorst moments before she was herself sunk by a salvo from the cruiser's 11-inch guns. The only man in Acasta to survive the sinking, after 3 days on a raft in the North Sea, leading seaman C.G. Nick Carter recalled, "When I was in the water, I saw the captain leaning over the bridge, take a cigarette from a case and light it. We shouted to him to come on our raft. He waved, 'Goodbye and good luck.' The end of a gallant man." A number of factors had coalesced to make the Norway campaign a disaster for the Allies, including frequent changes of plan, radio sets that General Sir Claude Auchinleck thought worse than the ones used on India's northwest frontier, and 1919-era Arctic boots that were several sizes too large, meaning that days were devoted to doctoring. Although the Allies were humiliated in Norway, and the myth of the invincibility of the Führer and his master race that had been sedulously promoted since the remilitarization of the Rhineland was further boosted, the German victory came at a high cost. Compared to the 6,700 British, Norwegians, French, and Polish killed, 1,500 on Glorious, and the 112 aircraft destroyed, the Germans lost 5,660 killed and 240 aircraft in the Norwegian campaign. While the Royal Navy lost one aircraft carrier, one cruiser, with three more damaged, eight destroyers and four submarines, and the Poles and French one destroyer and one submarine each, the Germans lost three cruisers, 10 destroyers, 4 U-boats, and several months in which Scharnhorst and Gneisenau were out of action. These figures may seem almost even, but the much smaller Kriegsmarine could ill afford such losses compared to the Allies, especially when General Franz Halder's plans to invade southern England on a wide initial front, codenamed Operation Seelöwe, Sea Lion, required much naval support. Once France fell in June 1940, the Germans had the Alsace-Lorraine iron ore fields and the Atlantic ports that took the place of Golivari and Trondheim. But 125,000 square miles of Norway still needed to be garrisoned for much of the rest of the war by at least 12 German divisions, totaling around 350,000 men. Hitler expected an attack on Norway for several years after 1940 and kept an inordinate number of troops idle there who could have been far better employed on the Eastern Front. It was not until after D-Day in June 1944 that they were brought south. He was right to fear an attack there, however, as Churchill always wanted to secure northern Norway for the Allies and prevent its use by the Kriegsmarine and Luftwaffe in their interdicting of the convoys that were sent to Murmansk after Hitler had invaded Russia. The ice-free ports of the Northern Cape were certainly useful to Germany in that respect. The German invasion of Denmark legitimized the Allies' capture of Reykjavik and the Faroe Isles the following month, which were to yield air bases vital to the anti-submarine campaigns of the Battle of the Atlantic. Furthermore, no fewer than 4.6 million tons of shipping, Norway had the fourth largest merchant navy in the world in 1939, were added to Allied resources and used from Murmansk to the Pacific. Since the entire aggregate of all Allied losses by submarines did not exceed that figure until December 1941, the Germans had to pay a high price for violating Norwegian sovereignty 24 hours before the Allies did. Speaking of Adolf Hitler in the Central Hall, Westminster, on the 4th of April, only 5 days before the German invasion of Norway, Neville Chamberlain said, "One thing is certain. He missed the bus." Along with his prophecy of peace in our time after meeting Hitler at Munich, it was one of his less impressive predictions. But he was not the only person to have spoken too soon. Churchill also told the House of Commons on the 11th of April that "we are greatly advantaged by the strategic blunder into which our mortal enemy has been provoked." The Norway campaign was a serious setback for the Allies, but if it achieved nothing else, the two-day House of Commons debate on the subject on the 7th and 8th of May 1940 did at least destroy the Chamberlain government and bring to power an energetic coalition under the premiership of Churchill. Ironically enough, the Briton most directly responsible for the Norway expedition and the Admiralty's unimpressive part in it. Winston Churchill's most important, most dangerous, but ultimately his most constructive characteristic had always been his impatience.
He had exhibited impatience throughout his life, both with himself and the world around him, especially during the imperial and world wars in which he had risen to prominence in British public life. By May 1940, he was 65 years old, yet still at the height of his very considerable intellectual and oratorical powers. His long years of largely unheeded warnings about the rise of Nazism had given him an unassailable moral right to the premiership during the parliamentary crisis that month, and he grasped it as soon as it became clear that Chamberlain could not carry on without the support of the Labour and Liberal parties and a small but growing band of Conservative rebels. Churchill was impatient for the premiership, and he took it, bluntly telling his rival for the post, the Foreign Secretary, Lord Halifax, that he could not be Prime Minister from the House of Lords. He later invented a story in which Halifax almost offered him the premiership out of embarrassment after a long period of silence. Churchill had a certain idea of heroism, both his own and that of the British people. And in 1940, the two came together in what in retrospect was a sublime way, but which struck many in the British establishment at the time as dangerously romantic. For over the past 40 years, there'd hardly been a major subject of domestic or international politics in which Churchill had not been intimately involved, very often on the losing side. His judgment had been called into question over such important issues as votes for women, the Gallipoli disaster, Stirling rejoining the gold standard, the general strike, Indian self-government, the abdication crisis, and very many more. He had crossed the floor of the House of Commons not once, but twice. Yet now his monumental impatience, especially once he had invented for himself the post of Minister of Defence immediately after King George VI had appointed him Prime Minister, was precisely what the nation needed. He demanded, in the wording of the red labels that he was to attach to urgent documents, "Action this day." And he got it. Churchill's preternatural eloquence and world historical sense, as well as his self-belief that bordered on the messianic, had brought to the fore in Britain a leader who could frame the global struggle in profoundly moving, almost metaphysical terms. In his unpublished essay of 1897, entitled "The Scaffolding of Rhetoric," Churchill had written, "Of all the talents bestowed upon men, none is so precious as the gift of oratory. He who enjoys it wields a power more durable than that of a great king. He is an independent force on the world. Abandoned by his party, betrayed by his friends, stripped of his offices, whoever can command this power is still formidable." Almost throughout the 1930s, what he called his wilderness years, Churchill's opposition to Indian self-rule, and latterly his warnings about Hitler's revanchism, had left him abandoned by his party, let down by his friends, and out of office. Now, however, he was about to wield a power more durable than that of a great king. But would it be enough? For on the very same day that Churchill became Prime Minister, Friday, the 10th of May, 1940, Hitler unleashed blitzkrieg on the West. Chapter 2. Führer Imperator. May to June 1940. "I asked you to go without sleep for 48 hours. You have gone for 17 days. I compelled you to take risks. You never faltered." General Heinz Guderian to 19th Panzer Corps, May 1940. For a quarter of a century, it had been the collective assumption that the plan to destroy France in 1914 had failed only because, between the plan's inception by Count Alfred von Schlieffen in 1905 and its being put into operation 9 years later, too many troops had been drawn off its powerful right flanking movement and instead assigned to the weak left flank. So when in October 1939 the Oberkommando der Wehrmacht, German General Staff, or OKW, planners were instructed by Hitler to create a new blueprint to destroy France, they produced Fall Gelb, Plan Yellow, which comprised a far stronger right flank attack by Army Group B, spearheaded by all 10 of Germany's panzer divisions, and an even weaker left stationed behind the Siegfried Line. Yet everyone knew that such a mass assault through Belgium and northern France was precisely what the Allies, given their identical experience of the autumn of 1914, would expect. Nevertheless, when, on the 10th of January 1940, a German courier aircraft flying from Münster to Cologne got lost in fog and was forced to crash land at Mechelen-sur-Meuse in Belgium, and Major Helmut Rheinberger, a staff officer of the German 7th Airborne Division, was unable to destroy his copy of Plan Yellow, either behind a hedge before he was captured or by attempting to fling it into a stove afterwards, Hitler was forced to consider entirely altering the OKW plans. In fact, because the neutral Belgians passed only a 2-page synopsis to the British and French military attachés the next day, refusing to say how they came by it, leading the Allied High Command initially to suspect a German deception operation, the alteration was probably unnecessary. The Belgians knew the plans to be genuine, however, since they had placed microphones in the room where the German air attaché subsequently met Rheinberger, and his first question had been whether he had destroyed the documents. Yet still they and the Dutch did not revoke their neutrality and join the Allies, fearing it might provoke the Führer. "If the enemy is in possession of all the files," Major General Alfred Jodl, Chief of Operations of OKW, wrote in his diary on the 12th of January, "situation catastrophic." Fearing Plan Yellow to be compromised, Hitler approved an alternative entitled Operation Sickelschnitt, sickle cut, the brainchild of Erich von Manstein, Chief of Staff to Gerd von Rundstedt, who was to command Army Group A in the centre. This comprised taking 7 panzer divisions from the right flank and positioning them in the centre, while keeping the left, Army Group C, as weak as before. After Army Group B in the north had attacked Holland and Belgium, it was hoped that the Allies would move into those countries to meet it, and then, at the key moment, Army Group A in the centre would burst out of the Ardennes forest, strike at the Schwerpunkt, point of maximum effort, the fulcrum in the Allied line, pierce it, and race forward to the English Channel, thus cutting off 1/3 of the Allied armies from the other 2/3. Hitler, who from the early hours of the 10th of May was based at his Felsennest, Cliff Nest, command post in the Eifel Forest, 20 miles southwest of Bonn, was later given personal credit for Manstein's new plan. Keitel described the Führer as the greatest field marshal of all time. And even 6 years later, he admitted to his Nuremberg psychiatrist, "I thought he was a genius. Many times he displayed brilliance. He changed plans, and correctly, for the Holland-Belgian campaign. He had a remarkable memory, knew the ships of every fleet in the world." Keitel also regularly told the Führer he was a genius. Dr. Goebbels' propaganda was, at that period, putting out the message that Hitler was the greatest warlord of all time. But at least Hitler knew that was state propaganda. To be told by one's chief of staff the same thing could not but induce hubris. Hitler's sheer knowledge of matters military was undoubtedly impressive, and has certainly bowled over modern apologists such as Alan Clark and David Irving, with the former stating that his capacity for mastering detail, his sense of history, his retentive memory, his strategic vision, all these had flaws, but considered in the cold light of objective military history, they were brilliant nonetheless. It was true that Hitler had a phenomenal recall for the technical details of weaponry of all kinds. Of his original 16,300-book library, 1,200 volumes can be found in the Library of Congress in Washington, and they include nearly a dozen almanacs on naval vessels, aircraft, and armoured vehicles, such as the 1920 edition of
The Conquest of the Air, a handbook of air transport and flying techniques, a 1935 copy of Hegel's Handbook of Tanks, a 1935 edition of The Navies of the World and Their Fighting Power, and a well-thumbed 1940 edition of Weyer's Handbook of War Fleets. There are exhaustive works on uniforms, weapons, supply, mobilization, the building up of armies in peacetime, morale and ballistics, wrote a Berlin correspondent of United Press International who was allowed into the Führer's library in Berlin and Berchtesgaden before the war. And quite obviously, Hitler has read many of them from cover to cover. Hitler's press secretary, Otto Dietrich, was deeply impressed with his boss. He had an exceptional knowledge of weaponry. For example, he knew all the warships in the world insofar as they were listed in reference works. He could give in detail from memory their age, their displacement and speed, their armor strength, their towers and weaponry. He was thoroughly informed about the most modern artillery and tank construction from every country. Instances when Hitler displayed his technical interest in weaponry during the war are legion. We're not asking pointed questions at his Führer conferences with senior OKW figures and military commanders. He liked nothing better than showing off his detailed knowledge. Subjects upon which he would dilate included the horsepower needed for wheeled tractors to pull heavy field howitzers, 85 horsepower, gear shift problems in the Tiger tank, the ricochet hazards associated with a 15-centimetre anti-tank gun, hollow charge projectile technology for anti-tank weaponry, the night flying capabilities of the Heinkel HE-177, the lowest altitudes at which elite paratroopers can jump, the percentages of ferries in Italy and Germany that were fully operational, altitudes at which mosquito fighters could fly, the top speed of electric submarines, 18 knots, the size of underwater bombs necessary to blow up submarine-based sluice gates, 3,000 kilograms, the advantages of flamethrowers over grenades over 30 yards, and so on. Yet, knowing the caliber of a weapon or the tonnage of a ship is far removed from being a strategic genius, and Keitel confused the two, unforgivably for someone with his role and responsibilities. Because a train spotter can take down the number of a train in his notebook, it doesn't mean he can drive one. Of course, Churchill also took a close interest in the minutiae of war-making, especially in tactics, but not so much in the technical side of weaponry unless there were problems associated with it. Whereas Hitler paid little or no heed to his troops' material comforts, Churchill was constantly interesting himself in such matters. Would there be brass bands playing when they returned home? Were they getting their post on time? On the 17th of July 1944, he referred the Secretary of State for War, P.J. Grigg, to a Daily Mail article about the way the troops were tired of compo rations and lacked bread. Grigg answered that 6 out of the Army's 12 bakery units were in France. "Should not put up with it," replied Churchill. "Ought to get decent cooked bread and meat." He instructed the War Office to accelerate the movement of mobile bakeries to France. Such an exchange would have been unthinkable at a Führer conference, not least because the German equivalent of the Daily Mail would not have dared to criticise the Wehrmacht over its rations. Manstein correctly identified the Schwerpunkt as the 50-mile-wide sector of the Meuse River between Donon and Sedan. Once that was crossed, the channel reached, and 40 Allied divisions in the north surrounded and captured, the rest of France to the south could be attacked from across the Somme and Aisne in a separate operation entitled Fall Rot, Plan Red. Speed was vital, and this would be gained by close cooperation between the Luftwaffe and advanced panzer units, as had worked so well in Poland. The panzer divisions would be grouped closely together to hit the Schwerpunkt simultaneously, taking advantage of the fact that, despite the lessons of the Polish campaign, the Allies had spread out their armour widely across the whole front.
Though the Germans were actually outnumbered by the Allies in terms of men and tanks, and used not significantly better equipment, their superior training, generalship, surprise, and especially Manstein's strategy would deliver the defeat of France. That strategy had come about as a result of a chance crash landing of a nondescript courier plane caught in fog. Manstein's plan, which Hitler approved in early February, contained significant risks. The Ardennes is a heavily wooded, mountainous region of narrow roads which was considered virtually impassable to heavily armoured vehicles. The left flank of Army Group A would be wide open to Allied counterattack from the south as it raced across northern France towards Abbeville on the Somme River and then northwards to Boulogne, Calais and eventually Dunkirk. There was a limited number of bridges over the River Meuse which had to be captured quickly. The weak left flank, guarded by the unarmoured 20 divisions of Army Group C on the Siegfried Line, would be vulnerable to the 40 French divisions facing it behind the Maginot Line. Over the last issue, the Germans need not have worried unduly. The Maginot Line was as much a state of mind as a line of fortifications, and there was no likelihood of the French surging forward from it to engage Army Group C. Named after a French defence minister of the 1930s, André Maginot, the line had been built between 1929 and 1934. Stretching from Pontarlier on the Swiss frontier all the way along the Franco-German frontier to Luxembourg, it was 280 miles long, comprised 55,000 tons of steel and 1.5 million cubic metres of concrete, and was connected by an underground railway, which still works today. After Belgium short-sightedly re-established her neutrality after the Great War, the line should have been continued all the way along the Belgian border to the Channel coast, and some extra fortification did take place. However, there were several difficulties. The technical ones, a higher water table in the east and the heavily industrialised areas of Lille and Valenciennes through which the line needed to pass, might have been dealt with, but the huge financial cost threatened to break the French military budget. Moreover, the Belgians somewhat hypocritically complained that an extension of the line to the coast would effectively sacrifice them to Germany, a factor that the French might understandably have taken in their stride, considering Brussels' repudiation of the defensive treaty on the basis of which the line had been built in the first place. As it turned out, although the majority of the Wehrmacht skirted round to the west of the line, the German First Army breached it south of Saarbrücken on the 14th of June, despite its lack of tanks, finding its shallowness meant that it was relatively easy to attack with grenades and flamethrowers. What had been originally intended merely to slow the Germans down and deny them the element of surprise had instead engendered a defensive mentality in the French that had, along with their 1870 defeat and the terrible bloodletting of 1914 to 1918, robbed them of offensive spirit. An all-out attack on the Siegfried Line in September 1939 was the French High Command's best hope, as officers such as General André Bouffre readily admitted, after it was too late. At the outset of the war, neither France nor Britain was politically prepared for such action. What the Allied plans, drawn up during the Ferny War, did propose was a swift movement into Holland and Belgium as soon as Germany invaded those countries, just as Manstein had predicted. Under Plan D, three French armies under Generals Giraud, 7th Army, Blanchard, 1st Army, and Corat, 9th Army, as well as most of the British Expeditionary Force, BEF, under Lord Gort, would move from their entrenched positions along the Franco-Belgian border up to a line between Breda and the Dieler River in order to cover Antwerp and Rotterdam. To allow these vital channel ports, invaluable for U-boats to threaten shipping, to fall into German hands was unthinkable. Yet, as the panzer strategist and historian Major General Friedrich von Mellenthin acutely observed, the more they committed themselves to this sector, the more certain would be their ruin. The Wehrmacht comprised 154 divisions in May 1940, and the Western attack employed no fewer than 136 of them. The Allies, once Belgium's 22 and Holland's 10 divisions were belatedly added to the total, numbered 144 divisions in the theatre. Both sides had around 4,000 armoured vehicles, with the German forces heavily concentrated in 10 panzer divisions of 2,700 tanks supported by mechanised infantry. The 3,000 French tanks were hopelessly disseminated in a linear manner, as they had been in attack during the Great War, while the British had only around 200 tanks in all. By dispersing their armour along the whole front, argued Melantin, the French High Command played into our hands and have only themselves to blame for the catastrophe that was to follow. It was true. The Allies had ignored the lessons of Poland. In the all-important sphere of air superiority, whereas the Allies had 1,100 fighters and 400 bombers in the region, the Luftwaffe had 1,100 fighters, 1,100 horizontal bombers, and also 325 dive bombers, of which the Allies had no equivalent. Allied planes were committed to aerial reconnaissance and defence, but not to close support of troops on the ground, a tactic which the Germans had perfected in pre-war manoeuvres and in the Polish and Norwegian campaigns, and which was greatly aided by the sophistication of ground-to-air communications. Much French heavy, field, and anti-tank artillery was actually better than the Germans, except for the Wehrmacht's superb 88mm anti-aircraft gun, which could double as an anti-tank weapon. And the British Matilda tank's 2-pounder gun was also a match for the German Mark III Panzer's 37mm gun. Yet this campaign was to prove once again how much more important psychology, morale, surprise, leadership, movement, concentration of effort, and retention of the initiative are in warfare than mere numbers of men and machines and quality of equipment. The German concept of Auftragstaktik, mission-orientated leadership, developed over the previous decade, was to deliver victory just as surely as any piece of weaponry they deployed. Early on the morning of Friday the 10th of May, 1940, Captain David Strangeways of the BEF, whose regiment was stationed near Lille in northern France, was woken by the battalion's orderly room clerk shouting, "David, sir! David!" It was only when he was about to rebuke the man for addressing an officer by his Christian name that Strangeways remembered that David was the code word for the event that the Allies had been waiting for since September. Hitler's assault on the West had begun. Considering that the Allies had been at war with Nazi Germany for over 8 months, it is astonishing that the Wehrmacht achieved such surprise as it unleashed blitzkrieg on the West, especially as only 1 month earlier it had equally suddenly invaded Denmark and Norway. The day before the quadruple invasion of France, Holland, Belgium and Luxembourg, the Belgian army had increased the amount of leave from 2 to 5 days per month, and in one strategically vital Belgian fort on the Albert Canal, the warning gun was discovered to be out of order. As many as 15% of France's frontline troops were on leave, and General René Priou, commander of her cavalry corps, was 50 miles behind the lines engaged in target practice. Army Group B, under General Fedor von Bock, made what Melantin called its formidable, noisy and spectacular attack on Belgium and Holland at 0535 hours. Many Dutch and Belgian aircraft were destroyed in their hangars for very light losses by the Luftwaffe. Paratroopers captured strategic points near Rotterdam and The Hague, including airfields, although fierce resistance the next day allowed Queen Wilhelmina and the Dutch government to escape capture. In Belgium, 11 gliders, towed by Ju-52 transport planes, landed on the roof of the great fortress of Eben-Emael, which covered the advance of Reichenau's 6th Army into the country. A mere 85 German paratroopers debouched from them and destroyed the fortress's massive gun emplacements from above with specially designed hollow charges, while its 1,100 defenders withdrew to defensive positions beneath the fortress. Later that day, Hitler told the German people that a battle had begun that will decide the fate of the German people for the next 1,000 years. The French commander-in-chief, General Maurice Gamelin, ordered the French and British armies to the Diehl-Breda line, where they advanced largely unhampered by the 12th of May, for, as Melantin recorded, the OKW was delighted to see the enemy responding to our offensive in the exact manner which we desired and predicted. When Giraud advanced too far into Holland, however, he was flung back at Tilburg. Some Allied generals, such as Alan Brooke, commanding the British Second Corps, Alphonse Georges of the French Northwest Army, and Gaston Biot of the First Army Group, deeply disapproved of Plan B, but Gamelin's mind was made up. The lack of preparation by the Belgians for an eventuality they had known was probable ever since the Michelin crash landing in January was illustrated by their not having removed the roadblocks into Belgium from France, which took an hour to demolish. Nor were there any trains on hand to transport French troops and equipment to the dealer, as King Leopold III of the Belgians complained to Major General Bernard Montgomery when British troops went through Brussels. All the Belgians seemed to be in a panic from the higher command downwards, noted Gort's chief of staff, Lieutenant General Henry Pownall, on the 13th of May. What an ally! Bad communications, mutual suspicion, and later on, mutual recriminations characterized the relationship between the Allies during this disastrous campaign. Matters were made worse by the way in which the physical organization of Allied command was ridiculously decentralized. Gamelin's headquarters were as far back as Vincennes, virtually in the Paris suburbs, because the commander-in-chief felt he needed to be closer to the government than to his own army. His field commander, Alphonse Georges, who'd never truly recovered from being wounded during the assassination of King Alexander of Yugoslavia in Marseille 6 years earlier, was based at La Ferté, 35 miles east of Paris, but spent much of his time at his residence 12 miles from the capital. Meanwhile, the French general headquarters was at Montry, between La Ferté and Vincennes, except for the Air Force, which was at Coulommiers, 10 miles from La Ferté. Even in the land of the chateau, this was taking chateau generalship ludicrously far. The attack of General Wilhelm List's 12th Army, part of Army Group A, through the Ardennes was a masterpiece of OKW staff work. Panzergroup Kleist, under General Paul von Kleist, comprising Heinz Guderian's 19th Panzer Corps and Georg Hans Reinhardt's 41st Panzer Corps, arrived at Sedan and Monterme on the Meuse on the 13th of May, at the perfect time and place to effect the Schwerpunkt against General André Corras' 9th Army. After fierce fighting along the Meuse, especially at Sedan, the far heavier concentration of German armour, closely supported by the Luftwaffe, broke the French force. Kleist ordered the crossing of the Meuse on the 13th of May without waiting for artillery support, because surprise and momentum were key to the success of Blitzkrieg. Time and again the rapid movements and flexible handling of our panzers bewildered the enemy, recalled a triumphant panzer commander years later. Colonel Baron Hasso Eckhard von Manteuffel agreed. The French had more, better, heavier tanks than we had, but, as General von Kleist said, don't tap them. Strike as a whole and don't disperse. The Battle of Sedan had a moral and historical, as well as a strategic, significance for Frenchmen. It had been there in 1870 that Napoleon III had been crushed by Bismarck in the decisive battle of the Franco-Prussian War. When General Georges heard about Corras' defeat at Sedan, he burst into tears. Alas, there were to be others, wrote Beaufre of the generally lachrymose French High Command. It made a terrible effect on me. Guderian was at Montcornet by the 15th of May, Saint-Quentin by the 18th, and his 2nd Panzer Division reached Abbeville on the 20th.
Fahrkarte bis zur Einstation!
Ticket to the last station, he called to his panzer troops, telling them to go as far as possible. At one point, Guderian was temporarily relieved of his command for going too fast, leaving his superiors fearful of a coordinated counterattack from the north and south, one that he intuitively guessed would never come. Little Hurt, an admirer of Guderian, described how the German tank commander had long been a proponent of the idea of deep strategic penetration by independent armed forces. A long-range tank drive to cut the main arteries of the opposing army far back behind its front. This was Guderian's moment to prove his pre-war theorizing right, and his detractors correspondingly wrong. By stretching the meaning of using his initiative to its limits, ignoring orders he disliked, and taking the wording of others far beyond their normal meaning, Guderian effected the sickle cut faster than anyone could have imagined possible.
I was conscious of a profound sense of relief, Churchill later wrote of his feelings when he finally got to bed at 3 a.m. on Sunday, the 11th of May, 1940. At last I had the authority to give directions over the whole scene. I felt as if I were walking with destiny, and that all my past life had been but a preparation for this hour and for this trial.
On the 13th of May, he gave his first speech as Prime Minister in the House of Commons, conscious that Neville Chamberlain received a greater cheer than he when the two men entered the chamber separately.
I have nothing to offer but blood, toil, tears, and sweat, he told Parliament, and soon afterwards the nation.
To the question, what is our policy? Churchill answered that it was
to wage war against a monstrous tyranny, never surpassed in the dark, lamentable catalogue of human crime.
Morale was a vital factor in the Second World War, and Churchill's oratory was invaluable in focusing British pride and patriotism. Stalin once cynically asked how many divisions had the Pope. Churchill's larynx was worth the equivalent of an army corps to Britain, as radios were switched on in the nation's homes at 9 p.m. to hear the Prime Minister's words of inspiration. Drawing on English history, mentioning figures such as Drake and Nelson, he pointed out that the British had been in dire peril before, but had prevailed. The hammer blows in May began to descend upon us almost daily, the military historian Michael Howard recalled, like a demolition contractor's iron ball striking the walls of a still-inhabited house. On the 15th of May, the Dutch capitulated, even though the De La Breda front line had not yet been broken by Army Group B. The bombing of Rotterdam had destroyed a large part of the city and left 80,000 people homeless, so the Dutch commander-in-chief, Henny Winkelmann, broadcast the Dutch surrender on Hilversum Radio before any other cities were subjected to a similar fate. Although only 980 people died in the raid, it became a stark symbol of Nazi terror tactics. The fear of such bombings caused an exodus of between 6 and 10 million terrified French refugees from Paris and the areas behind the Allied lines, who clogged the roads southwards and westwards. 90,000 children were separated from their parents in the process, and the ability of the Allies to respond to the German invaders was severely hampered. On the 18th of May, the French Prime Minister, Paul Reynaud, reshuffled his government and high command. He appointed the 84-year-old Marshal Philippe Pétain, the symbol of resistance during the Battle of Verdun in 1916, as Vice Premier, and himself took over as Minister of War from the ex-Premier who had signed the Munich Agreement, Édouard Daladier, who became Foreign Minister. 2 days later, Reynaud sacked Gamelin and replaced him with the 73-year-old Maxime Weygand, who never commanded troops in battle, and who arrived from Syria too late to affect the struggle that was developing around the channel port of Dunkirk. Charles de Gaulle, at 49 the youngest general in the French army, commanded a spirited counterattack at Laon on the 18th of May, but was forced back. And a brave attempt was made by the British 50th Division and 1st Tank Brigade south of Arras on the 21st of May to break through the Sickle Cut and reconnect with the French forces to the south. If successful, this would have isolated Guderian and Reinhardt, but in the event, it came to nothing in the face of Major General Erwin Rommel's 7th Panzer Division and 88mm anti-aircraft guns being used as artillery. Rommel had won fame at the Battle of Caporetto in 1917 when, not even a captain, he captured 9,000 Italians and 81 guns. An instructor at the infantry school at Dresden from 1929, he wrote textbooks on infantry tactics and was commandant of the War Academy in 1938, before going on to command Hitler's bodyguard. A believer in remorselessly taking the offensive, Rommel understood blitzkrieg and had a superlative sense of military timing. With the French armour divided between three armoured cavalry divisions, three heavy armoured divisions, initially all held in reserve, and more than 40 independent tank battalions supporting infantry units, other than General René Priot's cavalry corps, no French motorised formations acted in concert during the campaign. Having failed to break through southwards, the BEF and French First Army fell back towards Dunkirk. Gaston Biot died in a car crash on the 21st of May, an accident that led to a feeling of inexorable fate overcoming the French High Command, whose morale, in Beaufort's view, was never to recover from Corat's defeat at Sedan. The next day, the 22nd of May, the RAF lost Merville, its last airfield in France, so that henceforth every British plane that flew over the Allied armies had to come from across the Channel, severely limiting the amount of time they could spend engaging the Luftwaffe. A full week before the evacuation from Dunkirk began on the 26th of May, no fewer than 27,936 men who were not central to the functioning of the BEF were evacuated, in an operation organised by Lieutenant Colonel Lord Bridgman of the Rifle Brigade on the continent and Vice Admiral Bertram Ramsay, the flag officer, in Dover. Cartographers, bakers, railway men, and other useless mouths to feed, as they were accurately, if rather uncharitably, described by Bridgman, were shipped back. A clear indication that things were not expected to go well. Nor did they. On the 24th of May, Army Group A and Army Group B joined forces to push the Allies into a rapidly diminishing corner of France and Belgium, by then stretching only from Gravelines to Bruges and inland as far as Douai. Then something astonishing happened. With Kleist's panzers only 18 miles from Dunkirk, indeed closer to it than the bulk of the Allied forces in the Belgian pocket, they were given an order to halt by Hitler that countermanded the Wehrmacht commander-in-chief Bauckitsch's orders to take the town. This specified that the line of Lens, Béthune, Saint-Omer, Gravelines will not be passed. For reasons that are still debated by historians, Hitler's so-called halt order of 11:42 hours supported Rundstedt's request to halt Kleist's panzers at the front line on the 24th of May and not move into the pocket. To the amazement and immense frustration of commanders like Kleist and Guderian, the coup de grâce that might have scooped up the entire Northern Allied force was not put into operation, giving the Allies a vital 48-hour breathing space which they used to strengthen the perimeter and begin the exodus from the beaches of Dunkirk. General Wilhelm von Thoma, chief of the tank section of OKH, was right up forward with the leading tanks near Berg, from where he could look down into Dunkirk itself. He sent wireless messages to OKH insisting that the tanks push on, but was rebuffed. "You can never talk to a fool," he said bitterly of Hitler, after the Führer was safely dead. "Hitler spoiled the chance of victory." When Churchill later spoke of a miracle of deliverance, it was one performed by the grace of Rundstedt and Hitler, as well as by Gort and Ramsay. It was the first example of very many cardinal errors that were to cost Germany the Second World War.
I must say that the English managed to escape that trap in Dunkirk, which I had so carefully laid, recalled Kleist afterwards, only with the personal help of Hitler. There was a channel from Ahr to Dunkirk. I had already crossed this channel, and my troops occupied the heights which jutted out over Flanders. Therefore, my panzer group had complete control of Dunkirk and the area in which the British were trapped. The fact of the matter is that the English would have been unable to get into Dunkirk because I had them covered. Then Hitler personally ordered that I should withdraw my troops from these heights.
Kleist was underestimating Rundstedt's important role in the initial decision-making. But with Hitler willing to take the ultimate glory for the campaign, he must also take the ultimate blame for not allowing Kleist to scoop up the BEF outside Dunkirk. When Kleist met Hitler on the airfield at Cambrai a few days later, he had the courage to remark that a great opportunity had been lost at Dunkirk. Hitler replied, "That may be so, but I did not want to send the tanks into the Flanders marshes, and the British won't come back this war." Another excuse Hitler gave elsewhere was that mechanical failures and the subsequent offensive against the rest of the French army had meant that he wanted to build up strength before passing on. Flying over Dunkirk in September 1944, Churchill told André de Staël, private secretary to the Prince Regent of Belgium, "I shall never understand why the German army did not finish the British army at Dunkirk." The answer might be that by the morning of the 24th of May, the troops had fought continuously for nearly a fortnight, and from his own time in the trenches in the Great War, Hitler knew how exhausting that could be. Moreover, the ground around the Dunkirk pocket was not ideal for tanks. The infantry needed time to catch up, considering the startling amount of ground the tanks had crossed since Sedan, and as Franz Halder wrote in his diary, "The Führer is terribly nervous, afraid to take any chances." Too much had been achieved already to take the risk of falling into an Allied trap at that late stage, and there were still large French forces and reserves to deal with south of the Somme and Aisne rivers. Street fighting in Warsaw had also shown the vulnerability of tanks in built-up areas such as Dunkirk was. Furthermore, Hermann Göring was confidently promising that the Luftwaffe would destroy the pocket without any need for the Wehrmacht to do much more than conduct mopping-up operations afterwards.
He was mistrusting of his generals, Jodl's deputy, General Walter Warlimont, recalled years later of Hitler. Thus, at Dunkirk, he delayed the main aim of the whole campaign, which was reaching and closing the Channel coast before any other considerations. This time he was frightened that the clay plains of Flanders, with their many streams and channels, according to his memories of World War I, would endanger and possibly inflict heavy losses on the panzer divisions. Hitler failed to follow up the overwhelming success of the first part of the campaign, and instead initiated the steps for a second part before the first had been accomplished. Rundstedt himself, who was credited with issuing the halt order that the Führer later rubber-stamped, vehemently denied having done so. "If I'd had my way, the English would not have got off so lightly at Dunkirk," he recalled later with bitterness. "But my hands were tied by direct orders from Hitler himself. While the English were clambering into the ships off the beaches, I was kept uselessly outside the port, unable to move. I recommended to the Supreme Command that my five panzer divisions be immediately sent into the town and thereby completely destroy the retreating English. But I received definite orders from the Führer that under no circumstances was I to attack, and I was expressly forbidden to send any of my troops closer than 10 kilometers from Dunkirk." This incredible blunder was due to Hitler's idea of generalship.
This claim can be safely disregarded, since the order was given by Hitler at a meeting at Army Group A's headquarters in the Maison Blairon, a small chateau at Charleville-Mézières, only after Rundstedt himself had said he wanted to conserve the armour for a push to the south, to Bordeaux, where he feared the British would open another front soon. And anyway, the numerous canals in Flanders made it bad country for tanks. Hitler merely concurred. But as his Luftwaffe adjutant, Nicholas von Bello, recorded, the British army had no relevance for him. One theory that must also now be safely discarded was that Hitler did not expect or want to capture the BEF because he hoped for peace with Britain. Not only is it illogical, his chances of forcing a peace on Britain would have been immensely strengthened by eliminating the BEF, but there is a piece of hitherto overlooked evidence that proves that the OKW assumed the Allied force would be destroyed despite the halt order. A handwritten note from Alfred Jodl, written at Führer headquarters and now in private hands, to the Reich Labour Minister Robert Ley, and dated the 28th of May, 1940, states, "Most esteemed Labour Führer of the Reich, everything that has happened since the 10th of May seems even to us, who had indestructible faith in our success, like a dream. In a few days, 4/5 of the English Expeditionary Army and a great part of the best mobile French troops will be destroyed or captured. The next blow is ready to strike, and we can execute it at a ratio of 2-1, which has hitherto never been granted to a German field commander. You, too, Herr Labour Führer of the Reich, have contributed significantly to this greatest victory in history. Heil Hitler." The hubris of the letter is undeniable, especially since the BEF had started to embark from Dunkirk on the 26th of May. But equally, there is not the slightest sense that the OKW were holding back from attempting to destroy or capture as much of the Allied force as possible. Evidently, they believed total victory to be in their grasp. Although it was Rundstedt's initial decision to halt Kleist's panzers outside Dunkirk on the 24th of May, it took the Führer's influence to silence the opposition from Baukitscher, Halder, Guderian and Rommel. "We could have wiped out the British army completely if it weren't for the stupid order of Hitler," Kleist recalled later. Certainly, if the BEF had been captured wholesale, more than 250,000 POWs in German hands, there is no telling what concessions must have been wrung out of the British government, or whether Churchill could have survived as Prime Minister if he demanded a continuation of the war. Hitler knew how to use POWs as a bargaining tool, as he was soon to prove with his 1.5 million French captives. Kleist's belief that after the capture of the BEF, an invasion of England would have been a simple affair is hard to accept, as the RAF and Royal Navy were still undefeated, and the Germans had no advanced plans for getting men across the Channel. Although the Allied forces were overwhelmed at Boulogne and Menin on the 25th of May and at Calais on the 27th, Dunkirk was to hold out until the day on which the Allied troops in the pocket who could embark to Britain had done so. Ramsay and the British government initially assumed that no more than 45,000 troops could be saved. But over the 9 days between dawn on Sunday the 26th of May and 03:30 on Tuesday the 4th of June, no fewer than 338,226 Allied soldiers were rescued from death or capture, 118,000 of whom were French, Belgian and Dutch. Operation Dynamo, so named because Ramsay's bunker at Dover had housed electrical equipment during the Great War, was the largest military evacuation in history so far, and a fine logistical achievement, especially as daylight sailings had to be suspended on the 1st of June due to heavy Luftwaffe attacks. The halt order was finally rescinded by dawn on the 27th of May, and heavy fighting took place along the shrinking perimeter as the Allied rearguard, especially the French First Army near Lille, bought precious time for the rest of the troops to embark on several hundred ships and boats. That same day, 97 British prisoners of war from the 2nd Battalion, the Royal Norfolk Regiment, were massacred in cold blood by the 1st Battalion of the SS Totenkopf Division's 2nd Infantry Regiment, machine-gunned in a paddock in the inappropriately named hamlet of Le Paradis in the Pas-de-Calais. The next day, 90 POWs from the 2nd Battalion, the Royal Warwickshire Regiment, were executed by grenade and rifle fire by the Liebschandarte Adolf Hitler Regiment in a crowded barn at Wurmhout near the Franco-Belgian border. On seeing two grenades tossed into the crowded barn, Sergeant Stanley Moore and Sergeant Major Augustus Jennings leapt on top of them to shield their men from the blasts. These despicable, cold-blooded massacres gave lie to the myth that it was desperation and fear of defeat towards the end of the war that led the SS to kill Allied POWs who had surrendered. In fact, such inhumanity was there all along, even when Germany was on the eve of her greatest victory. Although the officer responsible for Le Paradis, Hauptsturmführer, Captain Fritz Knochlein, was executed in 1949, Hauptsturmführer Wilhelm Monker, who commanded the unit that carried out the Wurmhout atrocity, was never punished for this war crime and died in 2001 in a Hamburg retirement home. Already perilous as the Dunkirk perimeter came under full-scale assault, the Allies' situation worsened at 1100 on the 28th of May when, with minimum warning, King Leopold III of the Belgians agreed his country's unconditional surrender. This suddenly opened up a 30-mile gap in the Allied line, which was swiftly, but necessarily only partially, filled by Allenbrook's Second Corps. As well as 222 Royal Navy vessels, some 800 civilian craft of every type were called upon by Ramsay to sail across the Channel to bring the troops home. Some refused to heed the call, including some lifeboatmen and much of Rye's fishing fleet. But an armada of 860 vessels did take part, including pleasure steamers, liners, troop ships, trawlers, barges, ferries, and 40 Dunkirk coasters. Larger ships sometimes towed smaller ones across, and many went back and forth several times. In this, they were hugely helped by the weather in the Channel. For days, it suddenly remained calmer than a mill pond, recalled Signalman Payne. During the entire liftoff of that multitude, not a ripple was seen. This allowed men to stand up to their shoulders in water, and boats to operate within a few inches of freeboard, loaded to double and treble their safe carrying capacity. The calm sea was the miracle of Dunkirk. Pausing only to cut his many metal ribbons off a jacket.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.